Are you ready to rewind? Take a nostalgia-filled ride back to a simpler time. It's Acid Wash Memories, a retro pop culture celebration. And now your hosts, Joe Marotta and Michael Quinn.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode number 77 of Acid Wash Memories, a retro pop culture celebration. Today we continue the Seinfeld series, part four now, with season eight. I am Joe Marotta, alongside our own Kenny Banya, Michael Quinn. How you doing there, Michael?
Howdy ho.
Howdy ho there. Ready for more Seinfeld?
It's very hot today.
It is very hot outside, yes.
It's a Seinfeld day. We got hot and heavy action here.
Very hot
to cover
and heavy,
here
Michael
in
Quinn.
Season
Yes, season eight.
Season
thank you
Ocho.
Guys. Yes, the Ocho. Thank you guys so much for being with us here on Ask to Watch Memories. If this happens to be your first time joining us, well, I do want to tell you that there are 76 other episodes available. Where, Mr. Quinn?
In the archives.
In the archives. So you're sure to find something you like if you don't like Seinfeld.
The roasting archive.
There's going to be some roasting in this season as well.
Oh, yeah.
Of the chicken variety.
Oh, yes.
Which we will get
to. Lots of hot things today.
Lots of hot stuff. But folks, thank you guys so much for being with us for this cool episode, we hope. We really do appreciate you, whether you're a first timer or a long timer, and we would like to invite you to follow us on Twitter at AWM Podcast. An invitation, standing invitation.
Standing invite.
And you can also join our very friendly Facebook group. It's called, believe it or not, Acid Wash Memories.
Yeah. It's just
time.
The name of the show.
Yeah, a lot of research on that one.
We thought about it heavily.
Hot and heavily, Quinn.
It was like acid memories wash. We weren't sure.
Memories of acid washing. Like, we couldn't get it right.
It took a bit.
But folks, you can join our group there. It'll be a lot of fun. So we're going to get into it here because, as we always do, we have a lot of ground to cover. But I did want to preface this. If you guys have noticed, the last couple episodes, we've covered two seasons at once. And you might be wondering, come on, Joe and Quinn, are you trying to drag this out on us?
Come on, Joe and Quinn, are you trying to drag this out on us?
We're not. We want to give, especially season nine, but also this season, due coverage, right, Quinn?
The thing is, season nine's going to definitely, like, because it's the finale, and that was a whole cultural event in its of itself.
Correct.
It's going to need extra time.
And not only that, there was a bit of a reunion 11 years after the finale
on
a certain show.
Extra stuff to cover. So
we're just kind of going to break it up into the last two parts here. This is part four, season eight. Next time we do this, it'll be part five, season nine. But where we left off here a few episodes back was at the end of season seven. Seinfeld was the number two show that year.
Wow.
The big thing that we left season seven with in the finale, most Seinfeld fans, if not all, are going to know this off the top of their heads, is a certain character was killed off, her name being Susan Ross.
Right. Killed off. Which
killed
is,
off.
People were very surprised by this. I didn't expect it.
I didn't either.
I was like, what? People are dying on this show?
Julia actually said, I know, it's just, don't you want to just kill her? And Larry went, kabang!
And they did get some backlash for that, just for the cold tone of the way the characters reacted.
Yeah, it did kind of cement that everyone's an asshole here.
I think that's one of the defining everyone's an asshole moments. You know,
we've
talked about the arc of the show and how in a lot of those earlier episodes, like seasons two through four, five-ish, a lot of the times the characters are well-meaning, but things just get all, like, fucked up.
They're assholes by happenstance.
Right.
Like, right? It's like, it's not like they plan to be dicks.
Right. By the time we hit seven, and especially in eight and nine as we get into those, they're just cold, callous people.
They're almost, like, openly, like, admitting that they're shitty at this point,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, like, proud of it.
Yeah, they're, like, proud of it, right?
Exactly. Especially Jerry. He really turns into just a snarker all the time.
Oh, that's a shame.
But the other big thing that happened after season seven is somebody very important left the show.
Yes.
Larry David himself.
Which is weird. You would think, like, okay, time to pack up. The show's over, right?
Right.
Because Larry David was, like, the driving creative force of this show.
He was.
But now I just physically didn't want to do it anymore. I just felt like I just couldn't do another one. I don't know. I'd come to the end.
The bottom line with this is Larry David is very notable for being very mercurial. Okay?
He'll just leave stuff when he's done with it. Like, he's just like, I don't want to do this anymore.
Right.
He seems to be the kind of person that doesn't give a shit about money for whatever reason. Like, in my opinion, like, he's more just like, I want to do this. I don't want to do this. Like,
well, yeah. And, and Seinfeld to him was like, he only thought he was ever going to do the pilot. Then he gets sucked into it. And then he really took it seriously.
It feels like the most Larry David thing to do, to leave before it's over. Like, it's just like, oh, this is boring.
Well,
and then
part of it was he was just sick of doing it. But he thought that everyone would just say, okay, you're right. Let's just end the show.
Right.
I was hoping that everybody would feel the same way, but I was the only one.
No one else wanted to end the show.
That was the thing, right? Is by season 7, I mean, they were at their apex.
They had been,
and they
too.
Still, as far as television shows go, I feel like 8 or 9 seasons is always the kind of, like, limit, right? Not 7. Nobody ends at 7.
Not a really successful one, anyway.
Unless you get canceled.
Unless you get canceled for low ratings, but then you're not successful. Yeah, I know what you mean, Quinn. But the deal here was that he just wanted nothing more to do with it. And a lot of people have made a very fair point over the years, retrospectively, about how, you know, Seinfeld was maybe more Larry David's show than Jerry's. And to a degree, I mean, that really is true in terms of the sensibility.
But the only pushback I always give to that, I hear a lot of, oh, it was never as good when Larry David left and blah, blah, blah. But with that being said, I feel like the last 2 seasons have some very memorable episode.
Yes.
Like, stuff that, for whatever reason, even in its alt wackiness by this point and all that, they're like moments that people never forgot with this show.
Oh,
right?
That's true.
There's stuff that people, I swear, will like associate with earlier seasons. They'll be like, oh, that's from season 5.
Yeah.
And it happened in like 9 or 8
sure.
or something, right?
No, sure. That's going to happen probably as we go through some of these. But the other thing too is, you know, Jerry's stamp of approval was always on the show from day 1.
Right.
So it wasn't like he had no involvement in the creation. Activity,
but he didn't have the same creative input.
No, not as Larry David.
Yeah.
So what happens here is Larry had been the executive producer, the showrunner, if you will, right? Jerry takes that over with Larry David gone for seasons 8
and 9. I mean, who else
9.
Is going to?
Exactly.
It was an amazing challenge those last 2 years. It was so exciting, and because I was really undertaking a crazy thing to write and star in 22 episodes of a show that people are anxiously awaiting each week. It would have been quite the fall from grace if I had let it crumble. So he really gave me a chance to do the thing that I'm most proud of, which is that I learned how to do it really under him.
And he worked with a bunch of newer, younger writers who had the distinction of being Seinfeld fans from years prior.
Right.
Whereas the original slew of writers, you know, like Larry Charles and Peter Melman, they were just sitcom writers. They were friends.
They just came aboard this show that was coming about, and they were like, this is how we write it. Okay. They weren't like fans of Seinfeld.
Right, no, it was their job, right?
Yeah.
But now you have young sitcom writers. I'm talking like late 20s, early 30s, 15, 20 years younger than the previous crop. These guys loved Seinfeld. So now they start to weave in callbacks and weird little details, and they play upon tropes, especially in season 9, but also in 8.
I feel like this kind of thing would happen to like The Simpsons, for example, right? Like the writers became like they were fans of The Simpsons.
Yes,
you know what I mean?
The show's on so damn long,
yeah,
it's bound
exactly.
to happen, right?
So they had like encyclopedic knowledge of weird side shit that appeared for 2 seconds and then they'd make a whole episode about it.
Exactly right. So if you really want to see Seinfeld with Jerry Seinfeld's comic sensibility and his final stamp of approval, seasons 8 and 9 are the seasons for that. Now, I do want to say here, a lot of people, not Michael Quinn, but a lot of people do think that the show does take a dive in terms of quality in those last 2 seasons.
I don't, because it's all about the fact that there's so many moments that, again, people try to act like they were earlier. And,
right.
Oh, that
just
doesn't
forget when they were.
Or that's a one-off. And then when you look at these 2 seasons, you're like, it's not a one-off. There's like a lot of them.
And not only that, the show remained intensely popular.
Yes.
Till the end. Even I, who am more of, as you know, Quinn, I'm more of like, give me, you know, 3, 4, 5, 6, like the heart of the show.
Yeah.
I do prefer that. But I will say, especially going back and getting this episode together, a lot of season 8 episodes are really friggin' funny.
I'm not surprised.
And that's what we're going to talk about. I want to set the tone for you guys that are not as familiar. These last 2 seasons, starting here in 8, are much sillier.
Yes.
Quinn's favorite, the zaniness is cranked up.
The zane is great.
And the other thing we were saying earlier is almost any semblance of any of the characters having any redeemable quality are gone.
Yeah. I know a lot of people have seen the last episode and they know about the last episode, right? In regards to, as we get closer to the end, in retrospect, it sort of feels like that tone change was like maybe they had the finale in mind or something, like where they were going to go with it.
I don't think so, because someone else wrote the finale.
I understand that, but I just mean to say is like the fact that they really started hammering home that they're not redeemable is interesting considering where it went.
I think it's because that's funny.
Yeah.
I think it's just funnier to be like being caring isn't funny. Being sensitive isn't funny. Portraying that isn't comedic.
I guess.
And they were, if nothing else about Jerry Endler, they were in it for the laugh. Mm-hmm. Jerry's a born comedian.
Yeah.
His satisfaction, his chutzpah, no, that's not the right word, but you know what I mean.
Let's just say,
where he sows his oats is getting the laugh.
Let's just say it's like how good of people these characters were was really not at all the aim of this show.
No, it was just immaterial.
It was just like, can we put them in a ridiculous situation? Basically?
Right. It was, what was the old motto? No hugging, no learning. Right.
Yeah.
They were a stark contrast to like a Full House or something like that. But anyway, we needed to touch upon this too. We're going to get to the episodes in a second. George and Elaine's characters do change a bit here. Again, without Larry David there, George really turns into a very hot-tempered, yelling every line that he says.
He's like a parody of George.
Yeah.
Like he's like all his little stuff that was more like a subtle thing.
Yes.
Like, for example, like I always like to think, do you think I could be the general manager of a baseball team? Like that line.
Right.
These kind of thoughts that George would throw out and maybe never act on them or something. These are like things that no matter how insane George's thoughts were, he would act on them now.
Right. And the delusions of grandeur. Right.
Yeah.
As the late great grand wizard Ernie Roth would
say.
It's
like if you could envision it in George's mind, now George is going to go do it.
Exactly.
Right? Like
he's just cranked up to everything. Now, Elaine, too. If you recall early Elaine for about the first five, even six seasons, she was sweet. She was always vain and very superficial.
But a lot of this, to me, I always noticed was like building that the like corrupted Elaine was always a thing that was like slowly happening as the show went along.
I don't know if that was an intentional.
I don't even think it was intentional. It's just the result of like escalation.
Yeah,
like where it's just like suddenly she's like worse than they are.
Right.
Like, you know what I mean?
Like, she used to come off as like the best humane person on the show.
Right.
Like, she had her quirks and her hang-ups, and she was picky, but she was lovable. It's like Julia Louis-Dreyfus used to play her with a bit of, like, whimsy, kind of just, like, playfulness. Now she plays her as sick of it all, just pissed off all the time, overworked, just, like, tired. She's always wearing the business suits and, like, the weird clothes and stuff.
Always got to complain about something at Peterman's.
Yeah, like, she's not nice to... Remember she used to be, like, playful to Jerry?
Yeah.
And George, they would have, like, banter. It's just, she, like, hates everything now.
I don't mind it, because it's...
I don't like it.
Because I think it's
hate it.
I think it's funnier. Because,
well, there you go.
Because it's just, it makes her one of them, and I think it's like really funny.
I mean, I understand, but I don't know, everything about these last two seasons, every line is said louder and harsher and faster and more sarcastically. I know you don't. I do. And those little slice of life bits that used to come so natural with Larry David, like the little organic things, now they seem forced, like all the, like, now it's a Seinfeld conversation. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like the dialogue is like
I get it.
To be Seinfeldian instead of like the Larry David touch.
I see what you mean, but it doesn't make it bad either because it's still funny.
It's still very funny.
Yeah.
And that it's a sitcom.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be funny.
Mm-hmm.
And the biggest change here, there's no more stand-up. That's not the biggest change, but it's a big change. This is where, with Jerry now being the showrunner, he's like, I'm not doing these stand-ups in the beginning anymore. I don't have time for this shit.
No offense.
Right?
As the stories got more complicated, they needed that little run-up space to establish the beginning because it just like gets it out of the way.
Yeah,
like,
you got an extra minute to like, to tell the story.
It's always usually they're walking down the set, the outside set. Some shit happens, like, you know what I mean? With the logo just like in the corner. It's like we're not even like bothering with the stand-up shit.
Thank you guys for being with us here as we do season 8 of Seinfeld, which again, number 2, once again, second year in a row after season 7, number 2.
Who'd they fall to this time?
I don't have that information, but I don't think it was Home Improvement by 96, 97.
That's unnecessary.
No.
Didn't JTT leave by that point?
No, it was next season.
Aqua School or whatever he did. I don't know what it was.
Yeah, Costa Rica.
Yeah.
I think it is. Anyway, this is a September 96 to May of 97, season 8. The opener is The Foundation. This is where...
yeah, this. So, already I'm laughing because this is insane.
Susan's parent... Now, George is happy Susan's dead, which is, again, a cold, horrible thing.
Right.
Susan's parents, the Rosses, very well-to-do, they have set up a foundation in Susan's name, the Susan Ross Foundation.
My duties with the Yankees, you know, with
don't worry, George. The foundation will revolve around your schedule. Evenings, weekends, whenever you have free time.
There's this big portrait of Susan on the wall of this place where it is.
It's like creepy, too.
Yeah, it's a creepy portrait. And basically, the guy that oversees it, his name is Wick.
Yeah.
Which, there's a great scene where he introduces himself and George is like, Wink? Wick? Wick? Like, why Wick?
George? Oh. I'm Wick Thayer, chairman of the Susan Ross Foundation. Wink? Wick? Wick?
Notice how we're already getting, like, ludicrous, immediately.
Even the cold open, they're at Susan's funeral, and they're talking about Star Trek. Remember, they're at the... It's horrible. Also, in the, and of course...
That's so dumb.
George hates it all, because he thought, like, all right, I'm off the hook. Now he's got to donate all his time to the foundation.
Well, the only thing I will say is that he was, like, this makes sense in the line of, like, he was trying to get out of the relationship before he got married in the first place.
Yes.
This wasn't like, oh, we need to make this funny now. It was like, no, this was, like, part of the plot.
It's just funny because he could have just broken up with her at any time if he really wanted out, right? I mean, that's the shallowness and the insecurity.
Because he didn't want to work for the breakup even, because he thought there would be like a bunch of stuff he would have to do.
Yeah,
and he's just so
deal
fucking,
with.
He's so fucking lazy.
Fucking George.
Yeah.
Jerry is back with a callback to season 4. Remember Mulva, Dolores, the one whose name he didn't know?
Oh, the junior man.
From that episode.
Okay.
This is the one where... because Jerry had quoted something from Star Trek to Wrath of Khan to the Rosses, George in the diner, there's that shot where George is like, Khan!
Yes,
the camera
yes.
spins around.
Yes.
Which they actually call back to in later episodes.
Look at where we're going here. We're talking about Star Trek 2.
It's getting stupid, right?
Yeah, yeah.
This is where Peterman has... Elaine still works there. Peterman has a breakdown. He goes to Burma, which is Myanmar, leaves Elaine in charge of the J. Peterman Company. So that's a thread for a little bit. Meanwhile, see, here's this kind of shit you like. This is where Kramer keeps bragging about how he's taking karate or karate, as
oh
he says.
Oh, my God, I love this.
So how's your karate class going?
Karate, Jerry. Karate.
I love this whole thing.
And who's he fighting?
Children.
Yeah. And he's beating their asses.
It's like this, at first he's like talking about it like it's a real workout and all this shit. Like,
karate, Jerry.
Like everyone's like, okay, whatever, Kramer. And then like slowly they realize that he's like at a kid's dojo.
Yes.
And it's like, what the fuck?
Based on a true story that happened to the writers.
Really?
Yes, Alec Berg and Greg Schaefer, whatever their names are. Yeah.
Oh, hello, dare little one. Yeah, that was, So... The guys, it was actually Jeff Schaefer, but I guess because, well, in a coincidence type of situation. Yeah. So like he does have a brother named Greg, but I don't think the guy, Joseph, I don't think he actually knew that, though.
So that's how we kick it off. A totally different tone. Like, we're wacky, Quinn.
Doesn't that lead to, like, a really wacky scene in an alley where Kramer's gets beat up by the kids?
Right, all
something?
The kids. Yeah. They all corner him. Yep.
Yeah.
Folks, as you guys know, if you've listened to these, like, we can't cover... Time to disclaim, right? We can't cover every single plot point. It's a very dense show. But there's clips, if you haven't noticed, that supplement what we're saying.
Right.
And hopefully that covers things that
yes.
we miss. Episode 2, The Soulmate, is actually a very good one. So George... Here's George's thread, right? The Ross Foundation.
Yes. Still dealing with this.
He thinks that Wick and the Rosses think that he killed Susan. No one's saying it, but that's what George is suspecting. So he uses the old trick of leaving his briefcase in the room with a tape recorder in it.
I remember this.
Then later on, you know, when he plays it.
Hey, what are you doing?
Dear God.
As the audience, you're like, what the fuck happened?
Mm-hmm.
So he brings it to Wick, which again, I love the name, Wick. He brings it to Wick.
Reminds me of the Drew Carey boss,
yeah, and a Mr. Wick.
Yeah.
And they play it for everyone. And Wick is like,
George, Quinn here was moving a chair. He lost his balance and dropped it. Must have fallen on your briefcase, which for some reason contained a running tape recorder.
And then at the end of it all, after he leaves, they're like, do you think he did it? They're like, yeah. The irony. But that's George. Meanwhile, Elaine doesn't want kids, and some guy named Kevin that she runs into, well, he doesn't want kids either, so she falls in love with him. He gets a vasectomy, and then Elaine changes her mind. He's like, no, I think I do want kids, right?
Most Elaine shit ever.
Kramer, meanwhile, falls in love with Jerry's girl of the week, Pam. This is where Kramer teams up with Newman to try to, like, get her to fall in love with Kramer.
Kramer.
Hi, how are you?
Hi, how are you?
I'm great.
I, too, am well.
I, too, am well.
Do I smell Pantene?
Do I smell?
Pantene.
Pantene.
The Newman-Kramer plots become, like, extreme. They start getting, like, really crazy.
And it's funny because, like, if you notice, like, the life of the show, Kramer is the only person that likes Newman.
Yes.
Like, no, the others aren't antagonistic except Jerry, but nobody likes Newman or really wants to associate with him.
But as the later seasons went along, it's like Newman became more involved in Kramer's, like, schemes.
Yes.
Like, Newman was, like, very heavily, like, his, like, crony.
I love,
like,
when Newman is Kramer's crony.
Yeah.
Like, Wayne Knight, I think he is the highest recurring guest star. It's, like, 80-something episodes.
Like, there's a point, and it's especially by this point in the show, where I just felt like he was, like, the fifth cast member.
Yeah.
Like, he was just there.
Do you like Newman? I think he's a great character.
I think he's fantastic.
Wayne Knight nailed this role. Nailed it.
I feel like it would alternate as far as Kramer cronies between Newman and Frank.
And Mickey sometimes,
Mickey,
too. Yeah.
Mickey.
Mickey's in a bunch.
Yeah, Mickey is in a bunch.
Yeah, but Frank's the other, like, buddy comedy.
Yeah.
But it's usually a better purpose. Like, with Newman, it's a scheme. With Frank, it's like an idea.
Yeah, it's almost like Kramer looks up to Frank.
Yeah.
There's, like, a weird, like...
like the respect.
It's like that he's, like, older Kramer, and Kramer's like, no. Like, Frank knows he's smart.
He's
like,
wise,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, he's wise.
So this is another funny, silly, stupid episode. It's where, you know, Kramer's like, I love her, Jerry! Pam! Or whatever. Yeah. Her name, Pam! He just keeps saying her name.
Pam, what about Pam?
I love her, Jerry.
You what? I love her. Is that right?
Oh, she's real. She can bring home the bacon and fry it in the pan.
What does that mean?
Oh, and that voice.
What about her name?
Pam?
Oh, it's a beautiful name. Pam. Pam. Pam.
It's a good one, but the next one. Episode 3. This is one of the most famous episodes, I think, in the series, and it might have its detractors, because now we're just completely bending reality.
Good.
Do you remember Kevin from the one we just mentioned with Elaine? Right?
Yes.
Well, she breaks up with Kevin in this episode, but they stay friends. And then he introduces her to his friends, Gene Feldman, and even the FedEx guy, the neighbor, Fargus,
yes.
Right?
Hey, guys. Elaine, sit down. These are a couple of my friends. This is Gene, and this guy we just called Feldman.
Hello, Kevin.
Hello, Fargus. Want to catch a ball game this weekend?
Great!
This is amazing.
This is the Bizarro Jerry.
Yes, the Bizarro World people.
Yep.
Like, so... Now, Jerry, some background here. The reason I feel like this episode works so well is because it really plays off of Jerry's obsession with Superman, like, big time.
Absolutely.
Right?
And, big time.
And it tries to create a situation in reality that Jerry would understand in Superman terms.
Yes.
And it's fucking incredible.
And him and Elaine talking about it is really funny, too.
Yeah.
He's like your exact opposite.
So he's Bizarro Jerry.
Bizarro Jerry?
Yeah, like Bizarro Superman. Superman's exact opposite, who lives in the backwards Bizarro world. Up is down, down is up. He says hello when he leaves, goodbye when he arrives.
Shouldn't he say bad bye? Isn't that the opposite of goodbye?
No, it's still goodbye.
Does he live underwater?
No.
Is he black?
Look, just forget the whole thing, all right?
Kevin is nice and caring and, you know, sharing. And Gene, which is the George, right? he's thin and yes. he wears nice suits.
Yes.
And he's generous and like picks up the check.
They're the exact opposite, comically opposite. Every single facet of each character is played in reverse.
Feldman knocks before he enters right. Kevin's apartment. That's the Kramer. That's played, by the way, by future Mad TV cast member Pat Kilbane. Mm-hmm. He was on Mad TV the season after this. But anyway, yeah, and he comes up with ideas, but they're good ideas.
I would say the best part of this episode to me is the point at which Elaine's on the street. She sees Jerry, Kramer, and George coming up on one side, and then yes. like Feldman and all those Gene and Kevin coming up on the other side, and she has to like choose.
Yeah, that's the famous screenshot. Yeah, that's actually the title of the title card of our episode today.
To me, it's brilliant. Like it's like a brilliant freaking moment, and it's really funny.
Jerry, George, Kramer. This is Kevin, Gene, and Feldman.
And remember, she chooses the Bizarros.
Yeah, she does.
So meanwhile, in that little scene you just described, when she chooses the Bizarros, she's like, I can't, right? Yeah. I can't, guys, bye. And she goes with the good Bizarro ones. George walks up to her, and he's like, can I come?
Yeah.
And she's like, sorry, we already have a George. So this gets resolved where she's in Kevin's Bizarro apartment, which is literally Jerry's apartment flipped, and it's got a unicycle.
It's amazing.
Instead of a bike.
I love how like every detail was thought out with this. Like, it is insane.
Jerry's statue of Superman is now a statue of Bizarro.
Yeah.
Everything. The paint is different. Uh-huh. Like, the reverse color.
Doesn't it, like, his Mac is like a PC?
I think so.
Like, everything is opposite.
Everything's opposite. And what happens is she tries to do things that she would normally do with Jerry. She goes right into his fridge and he's like,
hey, what are you doing?
Eating olives.
Ever hear of asking?
So now you start to realize, like,
there's like a cost. Like,
there's a cost.
Because Elaine's from the corrupted world.
Right.
Like, she's like, what is this shit?
And then he gets tickets to whatever it is. And she does her Elaine, like, get out, yeah. shove. But he falls over and he gets all hurt and they all get mad at her and she can't be in the group anymore.
Yeah, they're like, why would you do that? Yeah, or whatever.
Like, way too sensitive about
it. Yeah, like, it's like they're like comically like babies, like, about this shit.
Yeah,
like,
it's on purpose, right? Yeah.
I got him. All right. Hey, Elaine. Feldman was able to get us all tickets to the Bolshoi. Fourth row center.
Get out!
What's the matter with you?
Kevin, I'm so sorry. Is there anything I can do?
Haven't you done enough already?
And then the other thing I just want to make sure we mention is they eat at the Bizarro Diner at
yeah,
Reggie's.
Yeah, they eat at the other one.
That's
yeah.
so good. But this is also the episode where Kramer accidentally works at Brant Leland because he was using the bathroom, remember? And he
yes.
starts going to meetings and he's got a briefcase and what's in it? Crackers.
Yeah. So This is the stuff I talk about where, like, sometimes stuff that's, like, very memorable in a Seinfeld episode is mixed into another episode where something very memorable also happened.
Yes.
And people, like, in their heads will, like, split them as separate moments and, like, separate episodes, which is just, to me, shows the brilliance of the show.
Absolutely. You want me to blow your mind again with that same concept?
Sure.
This is also Manhand's episode.
Wow.
Episode.
Now, that even me, I thought Manhands was like a completely other
so
thing.
Did I.
Because isn't there like an interaction where the multiple characters are involved with Manhands somehow?
Well, George is trying to get a picture of Manhands,
yeah.
and that's what they're running up to Elaine about on the street. And
right.
she's just like had enough of like all their shit.
I can't spend the rest of my life coming into this stinking apartment every 10 minutes to pore over the excruciating minutia of every single daily event.
Why not? Like yesterday, I went to the bank to make a deposit, and the teller gives me this look.
I'll see you later, man. I gotta go.
The whole system is breaking down.
Manhands is fucking incredible. Like, and what I love about Manhands is the blatant switching to actual
Manhands.
Like,
it's
so obvious that it's amazing.
Yes.
Like,
doesn't Jerry reference George Animal Steel?
Yeah,
I think
there's so many like stupid things with this.
Those meaty paws. I feel like I'm dating George the Animal Steel.
The fact that they even, like, put a woman's coat on a man yeah. so that you'd see, like, the woman's sleeve with the man.
It's just so dumb.
Yeah, it's so stupid.
It's really good. And the most famous line, I think, in this, besides the Manhands thing, is Kramer, when the boss, you know, his boss is like, these reports. It's almost as if you've had no business training whatsoever. Yeah. It's like, I don't even really work here.
It's so good.
There's just no way that we could keep you on.
But I don't even really work here.
That's what makes this so difficult.
Now, this might be one of my favorite latter era Seinfelds, that Bizarro episode.
It's very great. It's just very great.
Now, you and I can come to a truce on this, that this is in no way resembling like the heart of Seinfeld anymore.
I don't care. It's funny.
Right. I was going to say, though, we can agree this is nothing like season four.
Yes.
But it's still just as funny.
What I will say is that this is another example of how you said with the writers being fans of Seinfeld. This is something that can only be written by a fan of Seinfeld.
The Bizarro
that. The Bizarro especially. That is like expert level of detail.
It is.
Of understanding the show being applied.
Exactly right. Like they couldn't have done that in season four because they weren't thinking that way.
Right.
You know what I mean? Those writers. They were just trying to stay afloat.
But these writers had an acute awareness that the fan base had seen Jerry's apartment, for example, for so long.
Right.
And they knew exactly where everything was and what it looked like. Yep, and that if you reversed it, it would be so like jarring and funny. It would be like a good sight gag.
And even having the Feldman character coming in by knocking on the door, bringing groceries. Like,
if you notice, the audience is like losing their shit when like this whole set is just here in general.
It's a fantastic episode.
Yeah.
The next one is called The Little Kicks. This is kind of famous. This is where we learn that Elaine sucks at dancing.
It's more like a full body dry heave. Set the music.
It's dancing.
No, that ain't dancing, Sally.
I dance fine.
You stink.
Some would argue that this is another episode that the Elaine dancing became like a cultural like icon or something.
People know
like,
of it, yeah.
Like I remember seeing like mainstream stuff talk about this, like or like have like examples of it or lampoons of it, you know?
You gotta admire Julia Louis-Dreyfus willing to look like a complete fool.
Yeah.
With the horrible, like, jerky.
It's some weird mix of, like, the electric slide and, like, 70s dancing.
Yeah, like bomb dancing. Yeah, like R bombs.
It's like, some weird amalgamation of it all. My mother thought this was like hilarious.
So did mine.
Right? Like,
so did mine.
I don't know why. I always noticed that the female audience picked it up more than maybe the male audience did on this joke because it was just, it was great.
Yep. It's very funny. There's also another nice callback here again, the younger writers, where Jerry like has a flashback and you see what's supposed to be a few years earlier. Jerry's wearing like earlier 90s Jerry clothes and Elaine's got like the old Elaine hair with the dress.
It's really funny.
They nailed like the callback to like 92 again, Elaine and Jerry.
Like you said, the callback and the writers just knowing the show and they're like, this is what they should look like in this time.
Yes.
And we're going to, because it's like within the show's time frame, which is making it weirder.
Yeah, it's supposed to be like a few years
a thing
earlier.
That there just wasn't an episode about, right? Like it's just, it's really funny.
This is also where Jerry starts bootlegging movies. Remember that? And he gets like really into it.
Yeah.
And this is where, through a series of events where George tries to be a bad boy or whatever, he gets thrown into jail. Frank goes to the station to bail him out, but Elaine's also there. And this, there's that blooper reel where
Yes.
Frank's like, are you saying you want a piece of me?
Yeah.
Remember that? And, Julia can't hold it together.
Because he's being like insane. Like,
you want a piece of me?
And they have to keep redoing the take because it's just so stupid.
Well, I think because he's like, what the hell does that mean? Yeah. She can't on that line.
My George isn't clever enough to hatch a scheme like this.
You got that right.
What the hell does that mean? What the hell does that mean? You're saying you want a piece of me?
The next one is called The Package. I think that's a cue for Gene Okerlund to drop in here.
Well, what am I supposed to say? Seinfeld episode, The Package.
So this is where Elaine can't get her medical records because the doctors keep writing on her chart that she's difficult and they won't let her see it. Like that's not her fault. This is like a old school comedy where bad things happen, right?
Mm-hmm.
Kramer, meanwhile, wants to get Jerry a refund on a stereo. This leads to a great exchange, an oft-quoted one where it's like, they just write it off.
Yeah.
So we're going to make the post office pay for my new stereo now?
It's a write-off for them.
How is it a write-off?
They just write it off.
Write it off what?
Jerry, all these big companies, they write off everything.
You don't even know what a write-off is.
Do you?
No, I don't.
But they do. And they're the ones writing it off.
It's so good.
That's this one. This is where Uncle Leo signs for it. Because he happened to be at Jerry's. That also has the Newman interrogation scene with Jerry, which is a play on Basic Instinct.
Right, yes.
But Jerry's like, fine.
Also, Newman's in in that scene in real life.
Why is he in like notable movies, by the way? Like JFK,
It's funny that
Jurassic.
They brought the scene that he's in that movie
yes.
into the show that he's also in.
They
right?
did it with JFK also,
yeah,
with
yeah.
the Magic Loogie.
Yeah.
Crazy.
Pretty hot under these lights, Seinfeld? Pretty hot.
Actually, I'm quite comfortable.
This is where George thinks that Sheila from the photo place like slipped in a risque photo, so Kramer convinces him to take like those underwear pictures of George. Remember, that's a pretty famous like bit. And also, this is where Uncle Leo's stove explodes, so he has no eyebrows. So
that was fucking amazing.
Elaine paints them on and takes him to the doctor so she can try to find out what the hell, but they think he's angry.
Yeah, they like she tries to use Uncle Leo.
Of course. The weird, like, Elaine and Uncle Leo, by the way.
Well, that to me just kind of goes to show you how far Elaine's gotten, like, as far as, like, to get something done.
Yeah.
She will, like, there's no shame anymore. She'll just use Uncle Leo, of all people.
Nobody likes him either.
Yeah.
Generally. The next one is called The Fatigues, which is not a notable one for me. I haven't seen this one in a long time, but this is where basically Jerry's girlfriend has a mentor, and which Jerry's like fascinated by the concept of like an adult having a mentor.
Right.
And
I remember this.
Yeah. The mentor's dating Kenny Banya, which is funny to have him around.
Yeah.
He's a great character, too.
Why do they call it Ovaltine? The mug is round. The jar is round. They should call it Roundtine.
That's gold, Jerry. Gold.
Don't you like Banya?
He's all right.
Come on, Jerry. Don't you like Banya? You know? That's gold, Jerry. George, meanwhile, is supposed to do a lecture on risk management. I forget why exactly. And he doesn't want to read a book. Of course. Remember the whole Breakfast at Tiffany's thing all over again,
mm-hmm.
where he rented the movie. So he tries to listen to a book on tape, but he's like annoyed because he thinks the guy sounds like him.
Yeah.
In order to manage risk, we must first understand risk. How do you spot risk? How do you avoid risk? And what makes it so risky?
I think what you'll know about this, well, first of all, Kramer's involved at Frank's Knights of Columbus, because of course he is.
I mean, that sounds exactly like Kramer.
Why not be, right?
He probably heard Frank was in Knights of Columbus, thought it was amazing,
yep.
and needed to be involved.
Of course. But he wants Frank to cook food for them. And this gives Frank flashbacks of when he was in the Korean War.
Yeah, okay, yeah. And is this the young Frank, but it's just Frank? Like,
they don't even try.
It's amazing.
I was the best cook Uncle Sam ever saw. Slinging hash for the fighting 103rd. As we marched north, our supply lines were getting thin. Well, one day, a couple of GIs found a crate. Inside was 600 pounds of prime Texas steer. At least it once was prime. The news date was 3 weeks past. But I was arrogant. I was brash. I thought if I used just the right spices, cooked it long enough.
What happened?
I went too far. I overseasoned it.
It's fucking incredible.
Now, they did that for laughs, not laziness, right?
Yeah,
is
no,
that for laughs?
It's definitely for laughs.
They like, could have done anything else,
because it looks stupider.
Right.
Because it's like he's in like a sailor outfit that like a young person would wear. Like, and he's like a 60-year-old man. It doesn't make any sense.
So that's that episode, if you ever wondered. But this is also where the episode is named after, you know, the fatigues. There's a guy that works at Peterman. Remember, she's still running Peterman.
Uh-huh.
He's in fatigues and she like scares him or mm-hmm. he scares her. So instead of firing him, she keeps like promoting him. She's hoping that he'll like work himself out of a job.
Right.
And everyone gets all mad at her. That's where it comes from.
Oh, hello, Newman. See, because yeah. Because actually the guy who was in the fatigues was played by in the show is by Dan Castellaneta, who you might know as the voice of Homer Simpson and other characters on The Simpsons. the animated show.
Moving on to The Checks. This is where Elaine's boyfriend loves the song Desperado by the Eagles.
It's a good song. Well, you know, because of Hell Freezes Over album, I always felt like this song got extra play or whatever in the 90s. You know what I mean?
Why was it on? That's a...
Well, I mean, the radio was like real Eaglesy at this point in time, too.
Very Eagly, yeah.
Yeah, but to the point of like the Big Lebowski like making fun of it.
Good.
You know what I mean?
It's a funny scene. Now, but he won't let her have the song, so she tries to change it to Witchy Woman, which is another Eagles song. This is a weird like references.
Desperado. You better let somebody love you. Let somebody love you.
Meanwhile, this is where Jerry says that he invented the umbrella twirl when he was an umbrella salesman.
That's insane, but okay. I remember that too. Yeah.
He also keeps getting these like very cheap royalty checks from a Japanese TV appearance he did. This they try to parlay into like him getting the pilot like picked up in Japan. Meanwhile, Kramer meets some Japanese businessmen. They wind up sleeping in his drawers.
Yes. This is one of those also like I don't know why this became like a cultural touchstone of some kind, but the him like tucking them in at
yes.
night. I this like replay this in commercials and shit. Everyone knew about this.
I think it's just because it looks silly.
It
you
looks
know?
Insane.
Now the drawers get warped because of the heat. I forget, is it a sauna? I forget what happens.
Yeah.
But Jerry, meanwhile, gets writer's cramp from signing all the royalty checks. Remember, his hands like this.
Right.
He can't open the drawers, so he gets a fire axe. He's trying to chop them out, and thus he does not get picked up in Japan.
Right.
George's whole thing is he tries to join a cult, the Sunshine Cleaners, I believe it's called.
I don't even remember. I don't remember
it's
this
dumb.
At all.
It's dumb. By the way, George is still at Yankee Stadium, improbably, like, working for the Yankees, doing nothing.
Can I just say the escalation of how, like, improbable George's job is? It's like, it just, I feel like they kept it because it's like ludicrous that this person, because of who we know George to be, he should not have this job.
No.
Like,
and let's bear in mind, he got this job at the end, the last episode of season 5.
Right.
We're all the way up to 8. He still got it.
Yeah.
The next one is a very funny one. Another notable one from this season. One of the really good ones. The Chicken Roaster, it's called.
So, amazing.
This is a very funny episode. Yeah. The deal here is a Kenny Rogers Roasters opens across the street.
Can I just
from the building.
What an insane plot that is.
I know.
That's the crux of the issue.
And that is a real restaurant, by
right.
the way. Or not in the U.S. anymore. It opened in 91. Kenny Rogers, by the way, the singer, not the baseball player.
Right.
Just so we're clear on which Kenny Rogers.
Yeah. This opens up on the Manhattan set or whatever.
Yeah, it did. On New York Street.
Yeah.
Now, it's got this big red light that shines into Kramer's bedroom window from the chicken. From
right.
the big red chicken,
yes.
right?
What's going on in there?
What?
That light.
Oh, the red. Yeah, it's a chicken roaster sign. It's right across from my window.
Can't you shut the shades?
They are shut.
Kramer hates it, and he wants to boycott Rogers Roasters. Meanwhile, though...
Can we establish
okay,
how absurd this light is? Like, to the point...
It's so red and stupid.
Like, it's like he lives in a roaster machine.
Yeah.
Like, it doesn't... Like, it's like over the top. How like... Because there's like... They like show him like coming out the door and it looks like he's coming out of like an actual like roasting room
it's
or something.
It's insane in there.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I don't think that Kenny Rogers has any idea what's going on down there.
What are you doing?
So that's tomato juice. That looked like milk to me. Jerry, my rods and cones are all screwed up.
Jerry gets convinced into switching apartments with Kramer.
Right, because okay. he thinks it's not that bad or
right.
something, right? Like, he's like, you know what? If it'll make Kramer, like, stop being, like, go crazy for
yes.
we'll just let him stay here for a couple days. He'll get back on his feet and he'll go back, right?
Yep. So, meanwhile, Newman really likes the chicken and he brings it over to Jerry's, which
yes.
is now Kramer's apartment,
mm-hmm.
right? And Newman has this funny scene where he's, like, chomping, like...
It's, like, disgusting,
yeah.
too. It's like Wayne Knight playing up his portliness,
yeah.
like, to the extreme. Like, like, the chicken's, like, all over
yeah,
his
all
chest. It's all,
shit.
Like, greasy. It's, like, very fucked up.
And Kramer's like, is that hickory?
Yeah.
Remember? He's like, it's the wood that makes it good. just all, like, dumb shit.
The wood that makes it good!
It's, like, the stupidest shit.
What is that, hickory?
Yeah. It's the wood that makes it good.
Really?
Stop it.
And then Kramer gets addicted to the chicken.
Right.
But he doesn't want to tell Jerry because he loves the apartment. Right,
because there is like a weird subplot of like, we need to boycott them, like you said, right? Like, so right. It's like, there's this like, we're not supposed to be eating the chicken.
He tries to hide it from Jerry. Meanwhile, Jerry, who has been staying at Kramer's apartment, this is one of Jerry Seinfeld's best scenes in the sitcom.
This finally shows you where Jerry could go from range-wise, because like, this is like the craziest I've ever seen him.
Yeah, literally.
Yeah.
He comes in, I'll be dumping it in, but he comes in and does a full-scale Kramer impression.
He's just Jerry Kramer.
Yeah,
right?
He's like, Jerry Kramer.
Yeah.
I'm on no sleep. No sleep. You don't know what it's like in there. All night long, things are creaking and cracking, and that red light is burning my brain.
You look a little stressed.
Oh, I'm stressed.
That becomes the theme for the subplot for the rest of the episode is Elaine and George are now treating Kramer like they would Jerry.
So, yeah. So one of my favorite moments is that they clip to like Kramer in the Jerry apartment and now he's acting full like Kramer Jerry.
Yes.
And like he's got like a, I don't remember if it's a sweater or a blazer or some shit. Like he's all mild mannered. He's like nothing like Kramer anymore. Yeah. And he's like reading the paper and like all this shit. And he's like, he's less like wacky.
Yeah.
Like everything about him is Jerry.
I think there's another shot of him also at Monk's with, I think it's George.
So how come you didn't call Jerry about all this?
Jerry, I can't talk to Jerry anymore. Ever since he moved into that apartment, he's too much like you.
That's a shame.
It's amazing. And it's like the whole episode, he's just Jerry.
Yes. And then Jerry, meanwhile, is like, you know my friend Bob Sacamano? Like he gets like schemey with Elaine and shit.
So like Jerry starts referencing Kramer shit because he talked to Bob Sacamano on the phone and like now he's just Kramer.
See, he became Kramer.
Yeah.
You know my friend Bob Sacamano?
But he was Kramer's friend.
Well, he called last night about 3 a.m. and we got to talking. He sells Russian hats down at Battery Park. $40.
Meanwhile, Elaine, who is still running Peterman, buys a ton of shit on the Peterman expense account, and the CFO, or whoever it is, right, the head of finance, needs all these items. George had bought a very expensive big fur hat. He went out with a girl, and he did the old trick where he left something behind at her apartment so he can guarantee a second date, so he leaves the hat there, right?
Right.
She doesn't really like him. He calls her. She says she doesn't have the hat. That's where this Bob Sacamano things come in because Jerry gets George an imitation hat. You know what I mean? So anyway, the bottom line here is that she does start to like George. Remember, he's like he said it's like a jingle like by Menon, Costanza, that whole thing.
Costanza.
Anyway, it's a rat hat.
That's a rat hat?
And a poorly made one. Even by rat hat standards. I have no choice but to recommend your prompt termination to the board of directors. Nothing short of the approval of Peterman himself will save you this time.
But he's in the Burmese jungle.
And quite bad, too, from what I hear.
Wait a minute. Can I fire you?
No.
So Jerry's old friend from college that he ran into, he caused to be fired by Acton by telling him to blow off a meeting. Now he works at Rogers Roasters. Mm-hmm. While Jerry's in there talking to Seth at Rogers Roasters, Newman comes in, gets a ton of chicken.
Newman, you wouldn't eat broccoli if it was deep fried in chocolate sauce.
I love broccoli. It's good for you.
Really? Then maybe you'd like to have a piece.
Gladly. Vile weed!
Kramer, isn't it? I knew it. The greasy doorknob, the constant licking of the fingers. He's hooked on the chicken, isn't he?
Yes! Yes! No, please! Someone! Honey mustard!
Bottom line here is Kenny Rogers Roaster shuts down.
Right.
And Kramer gets very sad. Remember at the last scene, he's like, Kenny! Kenny, with like eating the chicken.
It is very good.
Very
good. The light
goes
off.
Yeah, the light goes off while Kramer's eating the chicken. And Jerry made a move back to his own apartment. The wood that makes it good,
it's
Quinn.
It's the wood that makes it good.
We'll do a few more here and then we'll go to break so we can get the second half of the season. The abstinence. George's girlfriend has mono. So they can't have sex for 6 weeks. This is where George, because he's not having sex, suddenly gets very, very smart, confident.
This
like,
is amazing.
Dresses well.
Like, everything about him changes. This is another let's transform the characters like right in a row.
Yeah, just fuck it, right?
Yeah.
Kidding? It's not about muscle. It's simple physics. Calculate the velocity V in relation to the trajectory T in which G, gravity, of course, remains a constant. It's not complicated.
Now, who are you again?
George Costanza, assistant to the traveling secretary.
Are you the guy who put us in that Ramada in Milwaukee?
You want to talk about hotels? You want to win some ball games?
Hey, we won the World Series.
Six games.
Elaine, meanwhile, is dating a guy that is in med school. She keeps calling him a doctor, but he's not, right? And they're not having sex so he can focus on his medical exam.
Right.
And Elaine gets dumber from not having sex.
Yes.
Are you all right?
I don't know. It's just it's the last couple of days. My mind has been kind of, you know... not good.
This is almost like the opposite. It's a play upon what they did for the opposite episode where Elaine turns into George, kind of.
Right, yeah.
But it's a more extreme version. Meanwhile, this is another thing that happens in this episode. Kramer starts a smoking lounge in his apartment. This is where, you know the scene I'm talking about?
I think I know what this is,
Where Jerry and Kramer... Jerry's like, your teeth are all brown. Your face looks like a catcher's mitt.
Yeah. It's disgusting.
Kramer's like, look away, I'm hideous. Like that whole thing. It's really good.
Your teeth are all brown.
Look away, I'm hideous.
And Jackie Chiles makes an appearance here because he thinks he's finally got the tobacco companies because look what they did to Kramer's face.
Right.
But Kramer, fucking it up like he always does, he settles without even seeing Jackie to get himself as the Marlboro Man on the billboard in Times Square.
It's amazing. Because only Kramer could end up in that situation.
Wait, how do you fuck that up?
How do you even end up as the Marlboro Man? That's, like, ridiculous.
It's good. George, meanwhile, because he's so astute and sharp now, he detects a slight Portuguese accent on the waitress at Monk's. And they sleep together, and now George is back to dumb again.
Yeah, dumb George.
That's what happens.
Yeah. Hey, where have you been? You know, you're on next.
I got lost on the way home.
Got lost? We went to school here for 3 years.
What are these?
Take me to your leader.
Oh, my God. You had sex. You had sex with Louise.
Next one is called the Andrea Doria. Do you remember this?
Not by name, no.
Okay.
You probably describe it, and I remember all of it.
It's named after George trying to get this really nice apartment, but they don't want to give it to him because they want to give it to this older guy who was a survivor of the Andrea Doria shipwreck.
Right.
Which, when Jerry tells George, it's like, it was like all survivors or whatever. Yeah. Like, it wasn't a tragedy.
That's it? I thought it was like 1,000.
1,660 survivors.
That's no tragedy. How many people do you lose on a normal cruise? 30, 40?
And then George has to like sit with the board and the guy tells his story. And then George like launches into all his things and it like clips to him saying all these shitty things that have happened to him over the years in canon. Very funny.
I was handcuffed to the bed in my underwear where I remained for she certainly seemed interested in me. Though she was attractive, she was also, in fact, a Nazi. The water that I had been swimming in was very cold. And when I dropped the towel, there had been significant shrinkage. My parents were looking at me. So there I was. With a marble rye hanging from the end of a fishing pole.
Meanwhile, this is where Jerry helps Newman on the mail route because if Newman does well, he can get transferred to Hawaii.
Right, and so Jerry wants this, of course, because it's endless, like, I don't like Newman thing.
What are you proposing?
Whatever it takes, for as long as it takes me. Wherever it takes me, as long as it takes you away from me.
An alliance?
An alliance. Now get the hell out of here.
And this is where Jerry, like, wears the male outfit. Have you ever seen those clips, folks? This is why. But he does too well.
Yeah.
Remember? He does, like, too good, and they knew it wasn't Newman.
Right.
And Newman rips the patch off.
Yes.
But it's... Jerry's like, you know this is your jacket.
Too many people got their mail! Close to 80%! Nobody from the post office has ever cracked the 50% barrier. It's like the 3-minute mile.
I tried my best.
Exactly. You're a disgrace to the uniform.
You know, this is your coat.
Damn.
But a tie to all this is where Kramer started going to a vet instead of a regular doctor because he likes vets more. He's got a cough.
It's the most Kramer. Only Kramer would think that this is acceptable. Like, as like,
so he starts taking the dog medicine and he starts acting like a dog.
That's funny. Like, because that's just stupid. That doesn't even make any sense, and it's hilarious.
It's completely stupid. And this is where he's coughing.
Does he start like scratching himself like a dog and shit? Like,
and like he's coughing, but it seems like he's barking, and he's trying to go up to the cops. Remember?
Yeah.
And there's a place called the Old Mill, and they're just parodying Lassie at this point.
Don't the cops literally say, "What is it, boy?" Yes. Or something to him?
That's some coffee. No, I think he's trying to tell us something. What is it? Trouble? Trouble where? Where's trouble? Trouble at the Old Mill. Oh my God. Good boy, good boy. Lead the way. Come on.
I love it.
It's so stupid, Quinn.
That's why I love it. It's so dumb.
But this is not...
It's making me laugh, though.
I know. It's making me laugh, too, but this is so broad. Like, I guess what I'm trying to say is this isn't even Seinfeld at this point. This could be like an SCTV sketch.
It is Seinfeld because it's capitalizing on the characters that we know and, like, their idiosyncrasies.
I guess so. I can't argue that. Oh, Elaine's thread here is she dates a bad breaker-upper. Who calls everyone names, and he calls her Big Head, and then she... Remember?
This is the man hands of the episode. Somebody with, like, stigmatize or whatever.
Exactly, those turns of phrase. And this is where she starts to get self-conscious about her head. Remember? Bird flies in and she's like, he flew right in your head.
Yeah. That, like, random guy.
Yeah.
He flew right into your head. Like he couldn't avoid it. Never seen that before. Word into a woman's head.
And then when she's in the cab, he's like, miss... You move your head a little more. Remember?
Yeah,
and she's
like
all the way down at the bottom of the cab by the end
of it.
It's
amazing.
Yeah, it's pretty funny. All right, last one before we go to break here. God, talk about stupid. The Little Jerry. This is where Kramer gets a what he thinks is a hen, but it's actually a rooster.
Yep.
What does he name it? Little Jerry.
Little Jerry Seinfeld. Remember?
You're right. It is officially Little Jerry Seinfeld.
That's his full name. Little Jerry Seinfeld.
It is. You're right.
I love this episode. And this episode
also...
I thought there was like some weird controversy in here because it's like there's cockfighting and stuff.
I mean, it is illegal, Quinn.
Right.
It's frowned
upon,
if nothing else.
Wasn't there like a little backlash here or something?
Probably.
Yeah,
yeah,
like
I understand.
In the media.
It's a really dumb episode, though. Are you kidding me?
Yeah, but Little Jerry Seinfeld is a great thing.
My favorite part about it is when they're at the thing and there's this giant fucking rooster it's going to fight. Kramer and Elaine and Jerry are all focused on the cockfight, right? And they have them like saying things in slow motion. Mm-hmm. Remember? Stop the fight. But George is like, tamale! This is also where Elaine is dating a guy named Kurt who shaves his head.
Oh my God, this is funny.
She sees his license picture. She's like, I could be dating this hair.
Yeah.
Remember?
Yeah.
She says that. All she cares about is the hair,
She's trying to like convince him to grow back in.
And he does, but it turns out in the few years since he's been shaving his head, now he's losing his hair.
Right. Now he's George.
Exactly. Yeah. And Susan Ross Foundation has donated a large sum of their monies to a women's prison. And George comes up, he falls for an inmate. He's like, it's perfect. She can't do the pop-in.
good.
Like, the pop-in.
I like that. I overall like the concept of using the Susan Ross Foundation as like launching points for like weird George shit.
It gives like a justification for why these situations are happening.
Well, it gives also George an alternate, whereas like most of the time his stuff was due to work.
Yes.
Now this Susan Ross Foundation, it's like a second stupid thing that George has to do, and it's amazing.
It is. It's very well done.
Yeah.
So, folks, that's half of the episode. I got to say, I'm feeling a lot better about this one than I thought I ever did. This is a very funny episode.
It's got, it's like I said, it sneaks up on you, but it's got more moments than you think it does.
I think that's true, Quinn. And folks, we'll be back with more of those moments on the other side of this break as we do the second half of Seinfeld Season 8 right here on Acid Wash Memories.
What's more amazing than the places you can go on the internet? The fact that you don't need a computer to get there. Web TV from Philips Magnavox. The internet now on your television at an affordable price.
They're looking for a few good men, but they're getting Bart Simpson.
Sir! Yes, sir!
Run for cover! It's the Simpsons season finale, part of a full hour Sunday.
So I got off the elevator and said, what is this, the seventh inning stretch? American Express.
Lovely.
Let's do the whole country. I'm a little light on the lingo.
You're getting a full gander down a frog with me.
All right.
We've got Cornish pasties, bangers and mash, pumpkin sweet and a lovely toadie out.
That was a wicked googly. So I took the butchers up the apples and pears and said, what is this, the tea interval?
All over the world, you can do more with the American Express card.
You don't see this every day.
Rock me, you can't stop me.
But you do see Wendy's six-piece crispy chicken nuggets for just $1.99 every day. They're tender pieces that are juicy on the inside and crispy on the outside.
To be or not to be?
And you don't see this every day.
That's the question.
But remember, you do see Wendy's crispy chicken nuggets for just $1.99 every day.
Whether 'tis noble. Look.
And now we return to more Acid Washed Memories.
Hey, welcome back to Acid Washed Memories, episode 77, Seinfeld, season 8, Joe Morata, Michael Quinn. Hello there, Michael.
Howdy.
Fun time so far, right?
Yeah, season's better than you remembered, huh?
It actually is. Still stupid, though.
It's delightful.
Is it zany?
It's so zany.
Is this the level of Zane that you like?
Oh, this is it. This is what I like.
Is this prime Zane?
Oh, I think 9's more zany.
I think so, too. And I think it is.
I love it.
We'll get there next time. But yeah, season 8, I didn't think I liked as much. And then I was looking through all the episodes. I'm like, wait, I like that one. Okay, maybe I do like this season.
It's good.
Maybe I have to eat some of my words. Mm-hmm. Not every word.
Okay? Wait till we get to season 9 and you'll really see that there's like way too many things in there that you seem to forget.
I do like a lot of season 9.
Yeah.
I just, all I've ever tried to say, and I still hold to it, if given the choice between the tone of like 3 through 5, and 8 and 9, I would always take the pacing, the tone, the characterization of the first.
Like, it's definitely better written, but like this stuff, in a weird way, I feel like these seasons were written for Seinfeld fans, the later ones. They're more the people who like have seen everything.
You know,
right?
I think that's fair, Quinn. They weren't trying to win new viewers at this point. They were already number 1 and 2 most of the time.
Yeah, it's all building on things you know about these people.
Yeah.
Like, and it's making the stories crazier because you've already seen everything. You don't need any more. You go watch the old ones. Right?
I guess that's true. They can't go to the opera again or the movies again.
Right.
Yeah, I get what you mean, Quinn. Let's go to the next episode here. This is The Money. So this is where Morty and Helen sell their Cadillac. Remember the Cadillac from a few seasons ago? They sell it to, making another appearance, Jack Klompus again. Right?
Your favorite. Yeah. You love Klompus.
It's very funny.
All right, I'll give you $9,000 for it.
$9,000 for a Cadillac? It's got no miles on it.
You bought it for $6,000.
You're not me.
How much do you want for it?
The Kelley Blue Book value, $22,000.
And they want to give that money to Jerry. They think he's having a hard time. He's not, right, financially. So he flies to Florida, buys the Cadillac back. They sold it for $6,000, I think it was. Buys it back from Klompus for $14,000.
Jeez.
Meanwhile, George and Jerry figure out that Frank and Estelle may actually be secretly rich, but they just never spend their money.
Mom! Dad!
Oh, look who's here! Hello, Seinfeld.
What are you doing here?
We're having an upscale dinner.
What?
Well, after talking to you, we realize we may not have much time left.
So, we're blowing it all.
Turns out they were right, and they're like, you know what? We're going to die soon. Let's just start spending. So now George thinking he would have an inheritance.
Right.
Now they're blowing it, right?
Your mother and I and Kramer have been talking.
Oh, God.
George, your parents can't blow through their savings in this community. It's low rent. Now, we feel that Florida is really the place where they should be.
You can drop a grand in Disney World like that.
Meanwhile, Jack Klompus drives the car into a swamp. There's also, like, callbacks. They call back to the Penn episode.
Yes.
All the way from season 3.
Well, I mean, if you're going to reference the old people, any of the episodes that go back to the Jerry's parents canon, like those, that group of people. Like,
parent canon.
Well, I feel like Frank and Estelle are part of it indirectly.
Yeah, I guess so,
but,
right?
But, like, it's still funny.
Tangentially.
Yeah.
Also, this is where Kramer's girlfriend has the Jimmy legs.
Oh, that's sweet, but actually, I think I'd prefer it if you left. You are completely right. I sleep so much better when I'm alone.
Hi. Take the pen. I said the line from, yeah, so anyway, because actually, the guys forgot to mention that Kramer's, his girlfriend, was played by Sarah Silverman, who you might know from, I guess, being Sarah Silverman. She's a comedian.
The next one is classic. If only for George's plot, which is at Yankee Stadium in a board meeting.
Yeah.
Eating a big shrimp cocktail.
Yep.
His coworker Riley says to him, which, by the way, that guy plays somebody, and I can't think of what it is off the top of my head. The guy that says this line is
everybody
somebody.
Everybody in Seinfeld was in something else, most likely,
generally,
because it's that kind of show.
It's just that kind of show. You're right.
Hi, you know, the actor you're talking about, he plays Wes Davidson in Home Improvement a few times.
He says, hey, George, the ocean called. They're running out of shrimp.
Hey, George, the ocean called. They're running out of shrimp.
And he's got nothing to say, mm-hmm. right? He has no comeback. And he's obsessed with thinking of a comeback. And he gets back to Jerry's apartment. And he's like, I came up with it. The jerk store called and they're running out of you.
It's good.
Jerry's like, what? Everyone's like, what the hell are you talking about?
Well, at my house, I'm laughing.
Yeah, no, it's very
hilarious.
Funny. And
it's funny that they don't think it's funny to me. That's
they don't.
That's the funnier thing, because it's actually funny.
Listen to the comeback. Oh, yeah? Well, the jerk store called. They're running out of you. But you gotta be kidding me.
How about this one? How about your cranium called? It's got some space to rent.
What does that mean?
Hey, here you go. Hey, Riley, the zoo called. You're due back by 6.
No, you're not helping me.
Look, just tell him you had sex with his wife. That'll kid him.
I'm not looking for another line. I got the line.
Look, George, just think about it. You know, you're married. How would you feel if somebody says to you that they just had
sex? All right, you see, this is why I hate writing with a large group. Everybody has their own little opinions, and it all gets homogenized, and you lose the whole edge of it. I'm going with jerk store. Jerk store is the line. Jerk store.
George wants to set this exact circumstance up again so he
right.
can use the jerk store
Tee
line,
it up.
Right? Yeah, he's very proud of his jerk store line.
Yeah.
But he finds out that Riley has been transferred to Firestone in Akron, Ohio. So not only is he not at Yankees anymore, he works for Firestone.
Can't even use the jerk store comeback.
George, because this is totally plausible, somehow works the Yankees into getting a meeting with Firestone. So he goes to Akron, Ohio.
It's like so absurd. Like nobody would ever do this at their job. Like,
never.
Like they would like set up a meeting just so they could get like a comeback from like some other time.
Right.
Like it has nothing to do with business.
So he brings the shrimp cocktail, right? Eating it all feverishly so the guy will notice.
Sets up the exact same situation.
The ocean called. They're running out of shrimp.
Oh, yeah, Riley? Well, the jerk store called. They're running out of you.
What's the difference? You're their all-time bestseller.
After all of that.
So then George takes Kramer's advice.
Yeah? Well, I had sex with your wife.
His wife is in a coma.
I just love the concept of setting up like a fake meeting.
At
like,
a company he doesn't work for.
At a company he doesn't work for.
Firestone.
With his company. So he can like get himself in trouble like all for just this one thing.
Horrible.
And it backfires on top of it.
And it all backfires. Meanwhile in this, Jerry plays tennis against some guy named Milos. And Elaine, remember the video store? She's like obsessed with this guy, Vincent's Picks.
Yeah.
She finally goes to his house and he's like a teenager.
Mm-hmm.
And he had to bring her like cigarettes and vodka and shit like
this
that.
This is the first time we've been on the video store set.
Oh, we've been in it several times. Yeah. You always like the video store set, don't you?
Well, because it's so like it really dates Seinfeld and it's just very funny that it's in there.
Oh, it's a video store, you mean?
Yeah.
Artifact.
My wife's in a coma.
Yeah? Well, the life support machine called and... Wait. Yes! That's what I should have said!
The next two I do not like. They're not memorable to me. I'm just not a fan of them. The Van Buren Boys, I bet you that doesn't ring a bell, right?
I love that one.
What?
Well, because I just always thought the concept of the Van Buren Boys was like the dumbest thing I've ever heard in my life.
Named
like
after Martin Van Buren. Yeah, like Buren, that they eight
were,
fingers.
Yeah, that they were like based off an ex-dead president is fucking... That is like
ex-dead president.
It's like incredible, right? It's
no,
like,
it isn't.
It's so stupid that it's amazing.
It's dumb. Come on.
It's a Kramer plot, right?
It's Kramer plot.
I'm taking on the entire Van Buren Boys.
Van Buren Boys?
Yeah.
There's a street gang named after President Martin Van Buren?
Oh, yeah. And they're just as mean as he was.
And also, this will come into play later, Elaine has been commissioned to write Peterman's autobiography. But she winds
I mean,
up,
she did work at the Pendant all those years.
She did, but she winds up having to use like Kramer's stories because his life was actually very boring.
Yeah.
So that becomes important later. The next one, again, I don't like this one. If you do, Quinn, fine. The Susie, it's where Elaine is mistaken for someone named Susie. So
I remember this. Yeah. Then
she makes an alter ego, basically, yeah, known as Susie, who dies, mm-hmm, and Peterman gets all sad. I don't like this one. I don't like this one
Elaine
at all.
Elaine has to kill off Susie because Susie's yeah, her.
This one is very convoluted and not funny. This is a trying too hard one, and I'm sorry.
Believe it or not, George isn't at home. Please leave a message at the beep. I must be out or I pick up the phone. Where could I be? Believe it or not, I'm not home.
However, we get redeemed with the next one, the pothole.
Yes, okay. This is good. This is very good. Yeah, I know you would love this one.
I like this one.
This plays off something you like.
First of all, Kristen Davis is Jerry's new girlfriend, Jenna.
Right.
That's Sex and the City,
which,
obviously.
I mean, Jerry dated basically anybody, any woman that was on a 90s show, period. So this is this felt like it was just coming. It was eventually going to happen.
Yeah,
right?
Of course it was.
Morning.
Morning.
Hope you don't mind baking soda flavor.
Oh, baking soda, annoying little product. I can do this. I can do that. Why doesn't this stuff just shut up?
Grab you a towel.
He accidentally knocks her toothbrush into the toilet, but he doesn't want to tell her.
Right.
Remember, but now he doesn't want to kiss her because toothbrush.
Right, because he sabotaged her teeth.
Yes.
And now he knows that they have toilet water in them.
And he's also, this is by this season, especially in the next one, Jerry is becoming Danny Tanner in certain regards with like hygiene and cleanliness. Like,
he is. He has
those
like
qualities weren't there.
He has a little quirk that is starting to develop in his older age.
Yeah, that wasn't there like five years
people
ago.
People could develop that shit. I mean, I assume Frank wasn't always insane.
Like, I don't know. Yeah. Maybe he was. Meanwhile, George loses his keys, which have a little Phil Rizzuto thing on them.
This is incredible.
Yeah.
That is like the crux of like the build up to the end, right?
They fall into a pothole, mm-hmm, which then gets paved over.
As I jumped over the hole, I heard like a jingling sound.
You didn't look down?
I was trying to stick the landing. No. No!
Holy cow! Poor son of a bitch.
So this leads to that very famous scene of George with the hard hat and the jackhammer.
Right, yeah.
And of course, doesn't he like fuck something up?
Yeah.
And the Phil Rizzuto thing goes flying.
Holy cow. And that's like when the credits roll,
very
if I remember.
Funny. Very
funny. Very good.
Kramer, meanwhile, does the Adopt a Highway program.
Amazing.
Remember this?
This is so good.
And he's leaning out of the car,
yes,
painting black lines to make extra wide lanes.
So basically, like, Kramer gets like jealous or something of like other, like, people who have adopted highways and have done, like, better things or something. So he starts, like, thinking up ideas of, like, how his piece of the highway could be better. And he comes up with luxury lanes. And
luxury lanes,
and
yes.
And I think, doesn't he, like, sell this to Elaine who thinks it's, like, good or something? I seem to remember her thinking, like, or like, Elaine's driving on the highway at some point.
And she's like, this is great. That's what it is. Of course, it causes a lot of chaos and confusion.
Right. Wide lanes. This is so luxurious.
This is also the episode where near the end, we don't need to talk about why, but Newman's mail truck catches on fire while he's singing. And then he's like, oh, the humanity.
Yeah, on a singer like
sewing machine
yes, gets caught. You know, they had to like, I heard somewhere they had to like get singer to like sign off on that or some shit.
Oh, because of like liability?
Well, no, because their brand name, like they wanted the product placement in that position.
Singer wanted it that way, you're
saying?
Yeah,
they wanted it because then you would see a Singer sewing. Like, okay. It focuses on the machine and you see the logo.
We actually made a boo-boo in one of the previous episodes. When Elaine got banned from a Chinese place,
right.
We said, that did happen when she got blacklisted, but it is not the episode where she lives in the janitor's closet. That's actually this episode.
Oh.
But it's because she's outside of their delivery territory.
Right.
But she's like across the street.
Yeah.
Now she wants, what is it, like some kind of like flounder?
There's some like, it's like dish flounder that she really likes, which honestly this has happened to me with a place that wouldn't deliver to my house that I would like dream about their food just like Elaine, and like I was like, man, I wish I had like a P.O. box or some shit like in range so they could deliver and I'd go pick it up.
Yeah, but that's what a half hour away from you?
Yeah, but you have to
this
go
is across
all
the street.
Way, you have to go all the way down the highway and like you can't do that in traffic.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. That's like a half hour for me. Right. This place is like across the street or
right.
something.
She's
it's
like
very
on
close.
The edge of the delivery limit or something.
So can I ask a logical question? Why didn't she just go pick it up?
Because that's bullshit.
If you want the flounder
no,
that badly.
I mean, I think she explains it. It's like the principle of it. Like, it's
yeah,
like
I
the fact
right.
that it's like literally the line is like on the other side of the
yeah.
street is kind of horseshit.
Yeah,
right?
That's what it is.
You're pretending to live in a janitor's closet just to get this flounder?
It's better than eating it alone in the restaurant like some loser.
But this is where they all wind up meeting up in the janitor's closet, which right. is, it's nice. Can I just say also, there aren't that many for these last two seasons.
Where they're all together.
Where they're all together. And it's still so nice when the four of them are together.
Ow!
Oh, oh yeah.
Oh, sweet setup.
Glenn, do you have any paint thinner? I need like 40 gallons.
And plumb out.
Dang. I don't get that black paint off. The city's going to go ape. I don't want to lose my baby.
So Jerry does tell Jenna about the toothbrush thing, and she goes into his bathroom and throws something of his in the toilet, yeah. and she won't say what, and it's driving him crazy. And finally, at the very end, we find out she threw his toilet brush in the toilet.
Right.
See, like,
which
not
is stupid.
Not malicious.
What is it? What is it?
Toilet brush.
Oh. All right, I can replace that.
You want to order dinner?
Yeah, let's go to your place. Because I threw out all my dishes.
I still think one of the funnier aspects of this episode is Elaine, like, in the janitor gear,
yeah.
like trying to, like, disguise herself in that, like, the, like, superintendent lady. Like, you want to, like, she's, like, complaining about, like, kids,
yeah.
like, breaking something.
Yep.
Like, it's like, are you going to fix that?
The next one, another good one. The English patient. Okay, so Elaine's dating a guy named Blaine. She really wants to see Sack Lunch, which is not a real...
Stupid. I love the fake movie name.
Yeah, Sack Lunch!
Yeah. It's good.
Sorry. It's such a dumb name.
It's the biggest, like, throwaway title the writers could have thought up.
Sack Lunch. So she wants to see it, but it's
how
still...
How much do you want to bet that was, like, somebody's failed script or something? Like, it's...
Well, I think... Remember Prognosis Negative was one of them.
Yeah.
From earlier on, like a fake movie.
Yeah.
That was a Larry David failed script.
That's,
so see, you might be right.
It probably was.
So they wind up seeing The English Patient, which was out at the time. She hates it.
My friends, who I don't even like, they won't talk to me, all because I don't like that stupid English Patient movie.
Really? I thought it was pretty good.
Oh, come on. Good? What was good about it? Those sex scenes. I mean, please. Give me something I can use.
Well, I liked it.
Hey, you forgot about my piece of pie.
And she tells Peterman that she's never seen it, because he's like, Elaine, did you see it or whatever?
Yeah.
He's back, by the way.
Actually, I haven't seen it, so I couldn't tell you whether I liked it or whether it really sucked.
You haven't seen it?
No.
That's it. Drop everything. We're going right now.
So he takes her to see it, so now she has to see it twice.
Horrible.
This is when she's like bitching in the movie theater the whole time, and these like older ladies are behind her.
Yeah.
Like, shit. She's like, I'll go to hell.
Yeah, it's good. It's
a very funny scene.
It's very funny.
Die!
Elaine, you don't like the movie?
I hate it! I'm going to hell!
This show, I'm sorry, but like the absurdity is like...
It's funny.
It's played correctly, and I don't care what anyone says.
No, listen, I'm with you.
Yeah.
I'm with you here for a lot of this. I like a lot of this. So Peterman's like, Elaine, you're fired. She's like, great, I'll be in the car. She winds up having to go to Tunisia to save her job because that's where The English Patient was filmed. Okay, meanwhile, a girl named Danielle, who was played by Chelsea Noble, who was Kirk Cameron's wife, by the way, mistakes George for her boyfriend, Neil. Bear that in mind because, meanwhile, there's so much shit in this episode, Quinn.
I mean, this is like how they are at this point.
Yes. This is where Kramer is going to try to get some Cubans. But by Cubans, we find out he actually meant Cuban people.
Yes.
Instead, he gets Dominicans, not cigars. Again, people. Jerry, we're doing human trafficking now on Seinfeld.
Jerry, Cuban cigars are illegal in this country.
And that's why I got these guys.
You're making your own cigars now?
Yeah, I got investors all lined up.
Hold on a second. Hi, Dad.
Who are they?
They're Cuban cigar rollers.
Don't tell your mother.
What is that bubbling sound? Are you making your tomato sauce?
Yeah, hot and spicy.
You're not wearing a shirt, are you?
Yes, I am.
What color is it?
Damn it.
Jerry, meanwhile, goes to Florida to see his parents. Kramer has given him a number one dad shirt that he got from some thrift. I forget. Morty's
hand me down.
Yeah. Morty's like all happy. Hey, you see this? Number one, Jerry. Right? And then we meet Izzy Mandelbaum, Lloyd Bridges. Like,
what is even happening right now?
You think you're the number one dad?
Remember? Yeah, it's good. Remember?
His whole thing is like always, you think you're better than me?
I think you're better than me, huh?
Hey, Izzy used to work out with Charles Atlas in the 50s.
1850s?
Yeah, that's it. It's go time. Let's see you lift that.
Mr. Man,
come on. Pump it.
I love it because, like, why would anyone get outraged about a number one dad shirt? It's, like, the stupidest thing I've ever heard.
And remember we meet his son, who's, like, also very old?
Yeah.
And he's like, you think you're better than him?
Yeah.
Oh, so now you think you're better than me.
You think you're better than him?
Look, let me just state for the record, I think you're both better than me.
He gets Izzy a world's greatest dad shirt, and Izzy Mandelbaum's like, see that? World's greatest dad. That's better than number one.
It's
what?
The competition.
How about that, huh? The world's greatest dad. My son made it for me.
That's very nice.
The best in the world, which means I'm better than just number one.
Well, I don't know how official any of these rankings really are.
This, to me, just plays off the stuff that you notice about older people, these, like, petty, like, grudges over nothing.
Everything
like,
in Florida, it's like, always petty.
Yeah, it's always, like, super petty. It's like no one would ever take a shirt like that seriously in the real outside of Del Boca Vista or wherever the fuck they are.
Del Boca Vista?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, you're right. That's where they are. So we also meet Izzy Mandelbaum's dad, who's supposed to be, like, 100, right? Yeah.
My boys.
My dad.
My grandpa.
Oh, come on.
What happened to him?
He was trying to lift the TV.
That TV?
Oh, no.
They all wind up in the hospital for various reasons because they're trying to compete with Jerry, like with random things. They're trying to lift the TV. It's bolted down. Remember, like all this shit.
All because Jerry got a shirt from Kramer that he didn't even give a shit about and gave it to his dad.
Gave it to Morty. It's funny. So back to these cigar rollers that Kramer was trying to get, right? He winds up getting them rolling crepes. George, with this girl Danielle, he's like, what's the difference between me and Neil? What's the damn difference? Like, why can't you just go out with me instead, right? Because they're the same. Well, Neil gets burned in the face due to these over-rolled crepes rolled by the Dominican people, right? So Danielle takes him to a clinic in England, because we have to call back to the English patient. God forbid we don't tie something together.
Well, it's...
Forced!
It's important.
Forced.
It's important, John.
Unbelievably forced. But anyway, this is... You know it is, Quick. Yeah. Like, come on now. That's it's getting dumb. Funny, yes.
It's in the show.
But this is a funny bit. So remember, George is in the hospital visiting Danielle, but Neil is there. He's all bandaged, so you can't see what he actually looks like. But as he's about to walk out the door, he's like, George, I win. And that's where you see George walk out the door, reach back in, and unhook the IV. And that is probably one of the, like, worst George moments.
What the fuck?
Pushing over the old lady.
Yeah.
the Susan Death reaction and just unhooking a guy's IV. It's like, fucked
what
up.
The hell?
But it's still funny. The next one's funny, too. Now we're getting into some funny ones, man. The nap. George figures out that he could just sleep under his desk.
This is amazing. Yeah. Like, this is so good because of the escalation and, like, the tools or gadgets that he figures out to put on. Like, it's so stupid.
So Jerry, meanwhile, is getting his apartment kitchen remodeled, like, new cabinets put in.
Yeah.
And the contractor is, like, very nice, but keeps, like, checking with every little decision with Jerry.
Right. He's too hand-holdy.
Yeah, he's, like, indecisive, right? Yeah. Like this? You want that? You want it like this or like that, right? Mm-hmm.
Hey, Jerry, are you okay with this hinge?
Yeah.
Because I can get you any kind you want, you know, 4 holes, 2 holes, bronze, no hinge at all.
You know, why don't we just go with the one in your hand?
Well, these are different.
Drop one. Left.
But George talks to him and he's like, hey, can you make a little compartment for me under my desk?
Right.
Put a blanket.
This integrates into his desk cannon.
And the guys look like a quilt or a blanket, like this, like that.
Yeah.
I think it might be possible to add a little shelf, like for an alarm clock.
What about maybe that big?
I don't know, maybe like this.
Like that?
Yeah, like that.
Yeah, I can do that.
Great. You know, this could sound crazy, but what do you think about adding a drawer for, like, a blanket?
Blanket or a quilt?
Blanket.
That thick?
Maybe like this.
Like that?
Yeah, like that.
That's what you want?
That's what I want.
This is where Jerry has, like, those big, stupid brown cabinets.
Oh, yeah, they're, like, bad or whatever.
Yeah, where there's, like, a window underneath, remember?
Is this because Jerry, like, said something like, just do whatever you want or something?
He's like, just do whatever, I don't care!
And then it's, like, horrible.
How about this? Finish this thing up today!
Couple questions for you.
No! No more questions! Just figure it out for yourself and get it done!
All right, Jerry. But I can figure it out myself any way you want.
Just do it.
It's amazing, like, the backfire. Like,
It's incredible. Now, these cabinets, folks, if you haven't seen them, it's like where they're completely out of place.
Yeah, like, it's like very, like, it, all of a sudden, like, the whole apartment looks way enclosed, and the whole crew is almost, like, offended by how shitty it is, right? It's like, everyone's just like, what the fuck?
Where are you?
Over here.
You can see right through here.
What is this? It's like you're selling movie tickets back here.
I think it's kind of cozy.
It's really, really, really funny.
Like, the cabinets are like make like a room now.
Yes.
Like, it's like
they make it like a kitchen room, right? And but they're like the wrong color. They're like brown. They don't go with
it's
anything.
Very good.
But anyway, so George gets this special compartment. There's that scene of him like with like a little reading table under his desk, and then the alarm goes off.
The alarm has like a little desk thing to like it's amazing.
Coffee cup down there. Yeah. And then he just folds it up and goes to lunch, right?
Right.
This is where George Steinbrenner returns. We haven't seen him. Again, Steinbrenner was voiced by Larry David, who also improvised or wrote the lines for Steinbrenner. Well, this time around, the lines were written for Larry David. It was the first time where he performed Steinbrenner not doing the lines himself. Yeah. Also, like, the Steinbrenner in this one, folks, those of you that really care about detail, this is not the normal Steinbrenner guy from the back because the wig is all, like, horrible.
Well,
the wig stinks. You'll see what I mean if you look back. It's, like, all white. It's
I think
really
at this
weird.
Point, nobody cares only because the idea of George Steinbrenner being in this show is already, like, ooh.
Oh,
like,
I know.
You know
it's
what
great.
I mean? Like, everyone's like, this is whatever.
It's
like,
great.
This is funny.
This is where he comes. It's like, where is that Costanza? And George is napping under his desk, but he wakes up. It's like, I got the song. She's a heartbreaker, love taker, you know?
And it's stuck in my head.
Yeah, it's stuck in my head. Where's Costanza? Hell no.
He was humming this song yesterday. I can't seem to get it out of my head. I got to know the name of that. She's a heartbreaker, love taker, brew baker, run this prison like a man. Oh. Something like that. Very catchy, too. Very, very catchy.
It's always funny every time we talk about this, the fact that, like Steinbrenner, like, knows George.
Yeah.
Like he's aware of him.
Yeah, this
minute. And he has, like, things he likes to talk about with George. Yeah. Like, it's very weird.
Yeah, remember the calzone? Like, all those other things. Yeah. So Costanza will know about this. Well, he hears the alarm clock ticking. He thinks that is a bomb. And he's like, it's coming from that desk. And they get, like, a robot in there to destroy the desk, remember?
Right.
So that's what it is.
Just empty calories and male curiosity, eh, George?
Also, this is where Kramer has been swimming in the East River.
Amazing. Okay, I remember when this aired, and everyone in my house was like, this is fucking hilarious. Like, this, because it's so disgusting
yes.
and like so outlandish.
Yes.
And like, isn't there a line where like Kramer's like, there's other people out there, and like, and it's like referencing the fact that there's like dead bodies and shit in the East River?
I think so.
Right.
For those of you that don't know, and they do say it in the show, but let's right. just confirm. The East River, A, is not actually like a river. It's like,
right.
it's literally, it's a tidal estuary, which is not like, it's not like the Hudson River, which is like a naturally flowing, it's enclosed, and it does have things flowing into it, but it's kind of like,
It has a reputation in the area of like, where you dump stuff when you don't want people to find out, or like garbage on like stuff like
yeah.
shit like that. Like people just for years before, like the, you know, obviously like they cared more about this kind of thing. People would just dump shit in it.
Oh, just totally.
Like companies would just dump chemicals in it. But anyway, so like the concept of Kramer swimming in it.
It's a shithole.
If you're from here, you're like, oh my God. Yeah, like that is disgusting.
It's really like, to be clear, it's not a river.
Yeah.
It really isn't.
But they call it the East River.
Yeah. It is a body of water.
Right.
You know, it's like, it's partially salt. It's partially saline, partially fresh. You don't want to swim in it.
You don't even
point.
Want to touch it.
No.
Like, it's disgusting.
You just ignore the East River.
Right.
That's the point. You just don't look at the East River. No, but anyway, so Kramer swimming in that was filmed in a tank, you know,
yeah.
in Los Angeles, and they put
but,
the
this,
New York
this,
around
this
it.
This concept was very funny to New York metropolitan area people. Like, this is like just
it is.
So ridiculous.
I like it.
I just found myself miles and miles of open lanes.
What is that smell?
That's East River.
You're swimming in the East River?
Yeah.
The most heavily trafficked, overly contaminated waterway on the eastern seaboard?
Well, technically, Norfolk has more gross tonnage.
The hits keep coming, Quinn.
Mm-hmm.
This one's known as the Yada Yada.
Yada Yada Yada.
That title comes from George, who's dating a lady named Marcy, who says yada, yada, yada. You know,
like fill in the blanks.
Yeah, as a way of saying long story short.
Right,
right?
Basically.
I noticed she's big on the phrase yada, yada.
Is yada, yada bad?
No, yada, yada's good. She's very succinct.
She is succinct.
Yeah, it's like you're dating USA Today.
But she yada, yada's sex, George thinks, right? She's like,
yeah.
you know, my ex came over, yada, yada, yada. I'm really tired tonight, right?
Right.
What do you think she was tired from?
Well, obviously the yada, yada. You don't think she'd yada yada sex?
I've yada yada'd sex.
Really?
Yeah. I met this lawyer. We went out to dinner. I had the lobster bisque. We went back to my place. Yada yada yada. I never heard from him again.
But you yada yada'd over the best part.
No, I mentioned the bisque.
But not only is this a yada yada episode, this is the episode where Dr. Tim Whatley has converted to Judaism.
Mm.
Jerry's at his office, and Whatley's got, like, Bryan Cranston, is who
yeah.
that is, has a really short hair in this one. Remember, his
yeah.
hair is, like, always different when he's Whatley?
It's true.
It's true.
That which reminds me, did you hear the one about the rabbi and the farmer's daughter? Huh? Those aren't matzo balls. What?
Tim, do you think you should be making jokes like that?
Why not? I'm Jewish, remember?
I know, but...
Jerry, it's our sense of humor that sustained us as a people for 3,000 years.
5,000.
5,000, even better.
So Jerry goes to confessional. I guess it's like Whatley's former priest.
Yeah.
Catholic priest. One of Jerry's, another great Jerry scene, because he walks in and he doesn't know what to do.
Yeah.
Jerry's Jewish, right? So he looks down at the kneeler and he just sits on it because he doesn't remember.
Yeah. He's like confused.
And then he knocks on the thing.
Yeah.
And there's a great bit with the priest. I'll dump it in.
Tell me your sins, my son.
Well, I should mention that I'm Jewish.
Well, that's no sin.
Oh, good. Anyway, I wanted to talk to you about Dr. Whatley. I have a suspicion that he's converted to Judaism purely for the jokes.
And this offends you as a Jewish person?
No, it offends me as a comedian.
But this is where Kramer accuses Jerry of being an anti-Dentite.
Yes, anti-Dentite.
Anti-Dentite.
Which is another cultural touchstone.
Yep.
Kramer, he's just a dentist.
Yeah, and you're an anti-dentite.
I am not an anti-dentite.
You're a rabid anti-dentite.
But not only that, this is where Deborah Messing is in it as
oh, yeah.
Beth. Kramer and Mickey are double dating. They can't pick which lady they want. Remember that scene where they're like both trying to get to the right, table, yeah, and they have like a big fight?
You ladies look lovely tonight.
Anyway, they go to the wedding. Remember, Mickey gets married. It's a whole thing. Mm-hmm. Very funny episode. The Millennium is the next one.
Yeah.
Plot point number one. Elaine has this big feud with Putumayo.
Yes.
The store.
This is incredible.
So she starts going to Cinco de Mayo.
Yes.
Turns out they have the same owner. So she enlists Kramer.
I knew where you were going the minute you met Puto de Mayo and all
that.
Yeah. Right? I was like, this is to me one of the funniest fucking things I've ever seen. It's like up there in Seinfeld lore.
It's so absurd.
So basically, they have some plan to like sabotage the store in some way, right? What was like the initial plan?
So the initial plan is Kramer is going to price gun everything at 99 cents.
Right, so that they like lose a bunch of money, yes, right? This goes awry. So Kramer hops in as, wait for it, J.P. Pennypacker. Yes, he's back, everyone.
Yes.
J.P. Industrial, wealthy industrialist yeah, or whatever.
Wealthy industrialist.
Right.
Hi, I'm a H.E. Pennypacker. I'm a wealthy American industrialist looking to open a silver mine in the mountains of Peru. And before I invest millions in a lucrative mine, I'd like to go a little native, get the feel of their condiments, their unmentionables, you know, the real gritty.
And he's absolutely fucking absurd.
Yes.
Like, he's got the glasses on and the whole, the popped collar and
yep,
everything.
Yep, the scarf or the whatever, the handkerchief.
Like, yeah, like the whole nine yards. So he isn't able to, like, price gun the shit or
right,
whatever. But instead he goes into the... He starts taking all the clothes into the changing room, and he takes out all the
desiccant.
The desiccant packets.
Yes, that keep it dry.
That keep it dry. And then his explanation when he comes out to Elaine is just...
I took these out of every single garment in the store.
What?
The desiccants. See, they absorb moisture. These clothes won't last 5 years without them.
That's not gonna do anything.
Patience.
All right, forget it.
What?
You have screwed me again, Pennypacker.
But that's not all. This is where Kramer's also throwing a, well, he's planning, not throwing, a Millennium party.
The Millennium,
yeah,
yes.
Remember, this is 97, but we're planning ahead.
Yeah.
And Newman does a competing one that he wants to call Newmanium.
The Newmanium, yes.
The blow on...
It's weird that Kramer's involved in that then in this.
There's like, a lot of Kramer in this one. The blow on this one is that Jerry's like, did you book the Millennium package? Now, if you folks remember, we did a whole episode on Y2K. Even though the proper Millennium started on 2001, right? January 1st, everyone and their mother was celebrating January 1st, 2000.
Right.
But that's like, the one people cared about.
But Jerry decides to point this out to Kramer, like, after the fact.
Well, because Newman booked for January 1st, 2001.
Interesting, because as everyone knows, since there was no year zero, the Millennium doesn't begin until the year 2001, which would make your party 1 year late, and thus, quite lame.
And then Newman makes a hilarious noise. He's like... You know who Jerry's dating in this one? Lauren Graham from Gilmore Girls. Lorelai.
Yep.
As Valerie. She does like speed dial rankings. Remember that?
Jerry dated everyone ever.
Like you said, like if they were on a show from around this time.
Never good enough either. Never good.
Never.
He dates freaking supermodels. It's just never enough.
Well, so, to be fair.
It's always some nitpick, Joe.
Sometimes they break up with him, Quinn.
I know, but Kristen Davis, because of a toothbrush, is he serious over here? That he dropped in a toilet, not him, not her.
You're saying you wouldn't break up with Kristen Davis?
No! Was he insane?
Just double checking.
Yeah.
All right. George's plot here, I know you like this one too. He hears that there's an open job as the New York Mets head scout. Now, that's actually his team. He and Jerry, in universe, are actually Met fans.
Right.
They'll watch the Yankees, they'll tolerate the Yankees, right?
Yes.
They're actually Met fans. So he wants this job, but he wants to get fired because he can't just go negotiate.
This is one of my favorite ones that's actually convoluted because it's just like, I love the lengths George will go to for this.
So he tries to do all these things to get fired. What's the
most extreme one is he takes the Yankees World Series trophy and he drags it in the parking lot. Like he attaches like a string to the end of his bumper.
Yes.
And he like drags the trophy through the parking lot and they like still don't fire him for right. some fucking reason.
Well, like, this is what it is. Right? I think one of the other ones he did do was like he wore Babe Ruth's original uniform.
Yeah, it escalates. Like at first it's like something like minor.
Yeah.
And it's like, okay, that would make sense that maybe they would just wouldn't they think it was a joke or something.
Yep.
Right. But then it just keeps getting more like crazy to the point of like just insulting,
and it gets to the point where he is about to be fired by Steinbrenner. It's like mm-hmm. Costanza, and then Wilhelm, George's immediate supervisor, busts in. He takes all the blame for it, and he gets fired because he wanted the next
right,
job.
Exactly,
that's good writing. This is actually yeah. good.
Wait, Mr. Steinbrenner, George doesn't deserve any of the blame for what happened in the parking lot today, sir. If there's anyone to blame here, it's me.
What are you talking about, Wilhelm? You popping pills? You got the crazies again?
Basically, like, all his plans are just used against him.
He can't even get fired now. Yeah. It's like the complete 180 of loser
but
George.
But this is what I love about the Yankee job. It's, like, comically, like, he can't get out of it. It's, like, so funny.
He can't get out of it,
like,
right?
It's actually a very George problem if you think about it, because before he can't get a job for the life of him, now he can't get out of a job. It's the same situation ultimately, just different.
I know what you mean, though. It's the same principle.
Yeah.
We got two more left in this season. The Muffin Tops.
This is another good one.
So George's line here is a pretty simple one. He watches a tourist luggage, and then he decides to go through it because he's fucking George. He starts wearing these touristy clothes, and he runs into a lady named Marianne who thinks George is a tourist, so she starts treating him, like, all kindly. Yeah. I think he says he's from, like, Little Rock, Arkansas or something.
Well, what if I told you I'm thinking of moving here?
George, no offense, but this city would eat you alive.
But because of this, he winds up having to talk to Tyler's Chicken, who is like a fake KFC.
Right.
Steinbrenner and the Yankees think that George is trying to work for Tyler Chicken, so George tries to get himself transferred to Tyler Chicken, and like the Colonel,
mm-hmm.
it's fake Colonel.
Fake Colonel.
Acts like a chicken.
Yeah, it's stupid.
And you say...
yeah, it's stupid.
It's stupid.
George Steinbrenner here. I want to talk about George Costanza. I understand he's been dividing his time between us and you. I cannot have that.
Well, I don't know who he is, but if you want him that bad, I'm not giving up that easy.
Oh, that's so. Playing a little hardball, huh, Donnie boy?
How about this? You give me Costanza. I convert your concessions to all chicken, no charge. Is that hot dogs? Chicken dogs.
Meanwhile, Peterman's got a book signing, because remember, Elaine wrote his autobiography.
Right, which are Kramer stories.
Yes, they are. And guess who happens to be publishing the book? Remember Mr. Lippman?
Yes, you love this callback, the Lippman,
yes.
like, pendant publishing thing.
I love that we're getting Lippman in 97, man.
It's way too late for Lippman.
Right.
Like, it's like, how is he back?
Because he had said earlier, a couple years early, he's like, you know, I want to start my own publishing company.
There's something very early 90s about Lippman in general that I can't put my finger on. He, like, almost, like, doesn't belong in this late 90s universe. Like,
he doesn't. That's why it's great. And he's still Lippman, right?
Right.
But anyway, he sees Elaine eating only the top of a muffin, and she's like, yeah, I get rid of the stumps. So they decide to open up a store that sells only muffin tops known as Top of the Muffin to You!
Yeah, Top of the Muffin to You.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh, yeah.
So what do we do with the bottoms?
I don't know, give them to a soup kitchen.
It's a good idea.
And one more thing. Do you really think we need the exclamation point? Because it's not Top of the Muffin to You!
No, it is.
Again, this is another, like, fond memory in my house. Like, everyone, this was so funny.
It is funny.
Like, also the concept that Elaine's, like, dumbass idea just gets stolen is just on top of it good for a good laugh.
Yes.
Like, I remember that being funny because you just, like, saw that scene or whatever.
Yep.
And just also just how ludicrous of a fucking business idea this is. Like, it's horrible.
It's terrible. And then remember also, like, Kramer's trying to help.
Yeah.
And he's trying to throw out all the muffin stumps.
The stumps, yes.
And just because Seinfeld liked to do this and it was very funny, mm-hmm. they would have people being belligerent for no reason. Remember the guy's like, you can't dump that here.
So, no, I love this.
That you it's can't like, dump that here.
It's like, doesn't he try to give them to the homeless or some shit?
No, he's just trying to throw out garbage. Yeah. That's all it is. Like, there should not be an issue here.
And somebody's like really like belligerent with him about this.
Like, you can't dump, that's just stumps. You can't, where's the rest of the muffin?
It's like, who gives a shit? Like, it's fucking amazing.
And Kramer's like, what's the difference? That's garbage.
Where do you think you're going?
Well, I was gonna dump this.
Doesn't look like garbage.
Well, it's
muffin stumps.
Where are the muffin tops?
This is a garbage dump. Just let me dump it.
Can't do it.
One of my favorite throwaway lines here is Kramer's like, is this a joke? And the guy's like, that's what I'd like to know about it. Like, he just says the phrase wrong.
Is this a joke?
That's what I like to know about it.
This is on the level of, like, sorry.
Yeah, like,
it's so, like, just a third-party person that's just like, why are they like this?
Why,
like,
are they an asshole for no reason?
Yeah, why are they doing this? Like,
I just like how he says the phrase wrong. That's what I'd like to know about it.
Yeah.
It just adds it. Just,
you're, like, questioning if this is reality at this point. Right. Like, you're like, what the fuck? Like,
and you know what? Speaking of reality, Quinn, we find out Kramer is pissed off that Peterman used his story, so he opens
I don't blame him.
He opens the Peterman reality tour, Quinn, which is a parody of the Kramer reality tour by Kenny Kramer.
The fact that they were able to work that in is fucking amazing.
And remember,
and this is what I mean, is this is the only way you could do this is two things. If you have the writers who are like fans of the show, so they remember this shit.
Yep.
And also, if you're just getting, like, turning the Zane up, like, to the extreme.
Oh, it's Zane, Quinn.
The fact that you can work in the Kenny Kramer reality tour into Seinfeld is unbelievable.
It's like a double meta reference here.
Yeah.
And remember, Jerry goes on it, and it's like horrible. It's Kramer driving a bus.
So good.
He trips getting onto it. You get a complimentary, like, pizza bagel or something.
Now when you make a pizza bagel, you really shouldn't use cinnamon raisin.
You also shouldn't use a donut.
And remember, you...
It's so good!
He's got, like, the tape playing.
Yeah.
And then, like, while the music's playing, you hear Kramer's voice on the tape. Turn music
yeah,
off.
Yeah, yeah, it's good. It's all good.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Peterman Reality Tour.
Turn music off. Kramer, can we just go?
And go we will.
What is this? It's a pound cake.
This is very funny. And then the other subplot here.
I'm like crying just like thinking about it because it's just so dumb.
I'm happy that you're so happy.
Yeah.
The other thing here is that Jerry started trying to trim his chest hair and he eventually like.
Yeah, he like couldn't get it even. So then it's all gone.
I shaved it all off. I did something stupid.
Yeah.
And remember he turns into a werewolf.
By the way, it's chest hair. Like nobody would see it. So like who gives a shit?
I know.
Like,
it'll grow back.
Yeah.
And remember he turns into a werewolf at the end. It's real.
Wait, is this the episode where they're like, there's conjecture about if it'll grow back thicker or some shit and he's like concerned
because his girlfriend does not like any hair what it is but anyway remember he's a werewolf at the end.
It's good.
All right, last episode of the season here, the season 8 finale.
Man, that flew by.
Dude, this is funny season. This is called The Summer of George.
Finally we're here.
We find out in the beginning of the episode, it is never actually specified. You can infer, you can guess. They never say, but George has been fired from the Yankees. They don't say why.
Right.
They actually don't.
Which is weird because they just spent a whole episode like of him trying to get fired, and now he's just suddenly fired.
Some people think it's because he wanted to work at Tyler Chicken in the last one, but that seemed like a one-off gag to
me. I think this is just like, fuck it. I don't think they care.
I don't think they care. They know Larry David isn't there anymore, so they can't just write Steinbrenner anytime they want.
Right.
You know, it was just a couple of times that they had
him. We'll just say he's out.
Yeah. But he gets a severance package from the Yankees equivalent to 3 months' pay.
Right. So he doesn't have to do dick.
He's like, this is going to be the summer of George.
Right.
I'm going to read a book from beginning to end in that order.
I've always wanted to do that.
I'm going to play frolf.
You mean golf?
Frolf. Frisbee golf, Jerry. Golf with a frisbee. This is going to be my time. Time to taste the fruits and let the juices drip down my chin. I proclaim this the summer of George.
Meanwhile, Molly Shannon cameos in this one, or guest stars in this one, is Sam. And she doesn't move her arms when she walks. Remember, she works at Elaine's office.
It's such an awkward, like,
yeah.
This is another observational name thing, whatever. Yep. I don't know.
And they get into a cat fight. Jerry and Kramer get excited about hearing the words cat fight.
Cat fight.
Jerry explains it. Now, Jerry and Kramer both go to the Tony Awards. Jerry is a guest of Lynette, who is played by Amanda Peet, another name from the 90s. Kramer goes because, of course, he does.
Now, isn't this where he's like a seat filler?
He's a seat filler.
This is fucking incredible. You know why I like stuff like this in Seinfeld? I like when they show you like it being aired on TV.
Yeah,
that shit makes it. It makes it more surreal.
Yes.
Like that, the characters who are fake on a TV show are on TV.
It's really
like,
funny.
It's just a funny sight gag. Like, it's really dumb.
I agree. So Jerry goes to pick up Lynette, his date for the Tonys. And when he picks her up, there's some dude there.
Jerry, this is Lyle.
Hey, how you doing?
Okay.
Have a good time.
Thanks. Lyle.
Yeah, the dude.
Lyle, yeah, some dude.
The dude,
so
yeah.
Jerry and George have a very convoluted attempt at a Seinfeldian conversation about this.
There was a dude.
What dude? Some dude. Her dude? I don't know. But it's like badly.
I think
it's trying too hard.
I know, but I will say this. Them just keep saying the word dude made it memorable.
Dude. They high five.
Yeah, yeah.
No, I mean, it is
referring
memorable.
To this just guy as a dude. Yeah, it's very stupid.
The whole scene is just some dude.
Yeah.
She had a dude?
Yeah, when I went to pick her up, there was this dude.
How do you know it was her dude?
Well, you think it could have been just some dude?
Sure, dudes in this town are a dime a dozen.
I reckon.
Or maybe she just wanted to go to the Tonys. I tell you what, you ask her out again, no Tony, just Jerry. That way you know if the dude is her dude or just some dude.
Dude.
Yeah.
So Kramer's in his seat filling it, but he happens to be in the seat of a cast member of Scarsdale Surprise, or at least next to the cast.
Another fake movie.
play,
whatever.
But they like rope him on stage. Like he doesn't try to.
Yeah, yeah.
They like bring him on. So he's on stage like
good.
Mugging like Kramer.
Yeah, it's so great.
While they're giving their acceptance for Scarsdale Surprise.
Isn't he like in the background or something? Like as if like he's one of the producers.
Kramering it up. You know, For Scarsdale is a town in New York, for those of you that don't know. In I think Westchester County, but it's like, you know, upstate New York. Upstate,
it's random. It's totally like throwaway, like stupid name for a play.
Right. Now, the star who is not there at the Tonys is Raquel Welch.
Yes. This incorporates now Raquel Welch into the canon.
Yeah. And nobody wants to fire her because she doesn't swing her arms when she moves. So we have to call that in now. We have to tie that into Molly Shannon. Again, because God forbid we don't tie things together in this show.
I know you don't like it.
No, I didn't say I like it when it happens more naturally. But anywho, they say that Kramer can keep his Tony if he fires Raquel Welch. Remember? That's like what it is.
So dumb.
So remember, we had Bette Midler a few seasons back in the finale interacting with Kramer. Now we get Raquel Welch.
When I was a kid, I used to really like... This used to like confuse me, these two episodes.
Same here.
Bette Midler and Raquel Welch ones.
Yes. Not as much as our friend, though, who once asked if that was Betty Midler.
Betty, yes.
On the screen.
Oh, right. We were watching that. Is that Betty Midler? Amazing. Anyway.
I don't think he's listening, but if he is, we love you. Anyway, so Kramer agrees, but, you know, she's not nice to Kramer.
You're still here.
Well, Miss Welch, I do need to talk to you about a little problem regarding your performance.
What kind of problem?
Well, it seems that due to the vagaries of the production parameters vis-a-vis the fragmenting of the audience due to cable television, carnivals, water parks.
Out with it.
Well, you're fired because you don't use your arms when you tap dance. You're like a gorilla out there. I gotta go.
This turns into Elaine and Raquel Welch getting into a cat fight because Raquel Welch thinks that Elaine's mocking her for not swinging her arms, but she's really talking about Molly Shannon, and the cops are like happy about it as it's happening off camera. I think one of them is janitor from Friends, from Scrubs, isn't it?
I don't know. But
I think it is.
Either way, the ongoing gag that cat fights are just okay. It's kind of stupid, but like they keep harping on it. Like, even the cops are like, this is fine.
I just checked. It is. That's janitor from Scrubs.
Oh, yeah, that is him.
Is one of them. See, sometimes I remember things that are correct. Yeah. Anyway, George. Remember, it's his summer. Summer of George.
Right.
So he gets invited to play Frolf, Frisbee Golf.
Yes.
Remember?
It's stupid.
Hey, Frolf?
Yeah. You know, we need a fourth for the back nine. You want it?
What's the deal with airplane peanuts?
Yeah, sure. Come on.
The guy, the portly fellow that invites him, is actually one of the writers, David Mandel. And they, like, wrote him in.
Good.
Like, he didn't write himself and the other, like, as a joke, they're like, no, you're playing him.
There you go. It works.
Like, you want to play Frolf? Remember?
Yeah.
Yeah, we need another guy for the back nine or whatever.
I just like that George is like this, like his life is like completely different now.
Yeah.
Like it's like super funny.
He has no Susan.
Yeah.
Now he has no job again. Jobless George is always funny.
He's got no job, but no consequences of having. He doesn't have to move in with his parents because he's got money.
He's got 3 months worth. It's pretty good. However, there's invitations that he's getting for Lynette is throwing a party. Lynette, the lady with the dude, right?
The dude.
So he slips on one of the invitations at his apartment, injures his leg, winds up in the hospital.
Yes.
The same doctor who we saw at the end of season 7 that informed us about Susan, also the same doctor from the Junior Mint episode, for the record, comes out and explains that due to extreme non-activity...
He starts, like, just saying doctory things.
Yeah. Your legs are in a state of atrophy.
Your legs have sustained extensive trauma. Apparently, your body was in a state of advanced atrophy due to a period of extreme inactivity.
Basically, the whole joke is it might be very hard for him to be able to walk again.
Right.
All, you know, Kramer, Elaine, and Jerry are all there. And much like the cold, callous reaction to Susan's death.
Yes.
Now they just kind of leave. George, like, okay, let's go.
Yeah.
And he's like, this is supposed to be the summer of George, right?
Wow. Invitations again.
Yeah, that's weird.
All right, well. Huh? You want to grab some coffee?
Yeah.
Or, yeah?
Coffee. Ooh, I'd like to get some coffee.
Okay.
We're supposed to be the summer of George! The summer of George!
And then they have the little tag scene where in physical therapy, George is like struggling to walk again.
Yeah.
And also in the same room is Raquel Welch trying to like learn to move her arm. So it's a nice little tag.
Hi, it was Molly Shannon, not Raquel Welch. Yes, it's me instead of Dave Meltzer. We don't have all day here.
I really always liked that finale. I thought it was good.
I thought it was a nice way to wink back at the audience and say, listen, we know
the Susan thing.
Susan thing, but look, George has not had a good year for the most part. The Ross Foundation, right? Susan Ross Foundation.
Deal with all that shit.
Wick. And now he loses his job. Fine, he's got money. Now he can't walk for the rest of the summer, right? They did it justice, I think.
It's pretty good.
I've got to say, Quinn, after recapping all 22 of these season 8 episodes, the first of 2 seasons solely with Jerry Seinfeld as the showrunner, as the final stamp of approval versus Larry David, who was very much the driving force creatively for the heart of the show. It is a different show. We both agree, but it is still extremely funny, right?
Yes, it's very funny.
Would you?
There's a lot of good moments. It's nonstop, too. It was like every week there was at least something.
There's only a few clunkers.
Yeah.
Only a few clunkers, really.
Yeah. And I feel like there was only like 2.
Yeah.
Like if I was kind of counting in my head, and it was like
there was only
two times where we just kind of like moved on.
Yeah. And I would also say that the humor is now more like vignettes, right?
Yeah.
It's more like sketches now.
But they're really leaning into the like 1,000 things happen per episode.
That's what I couldn't believe. Like the one where it's like, yeah, but man hands, but this, but that. It's like, what?
Yeah, these
Bizarro?
Are all like iconic concepts that were really funny and memorable, and they're all in one episode.
All in one episode. So, folks, we hope you liked this one episode. Like we said, we needed to do justice for 8 and 9. We had some preamble here about season 8. We needed the cover. And for season 9, we got to cover every episode there, plus the finale in some detail. Mm-hmm. So that'll be coming in a few episodes from now. But we really do appreciate you for being with us here. If you're a Seinfeld fan, let us know what you think of 8 compared to the other seasons. What you think of the Jerry Seinfeld-led era of 8 and 9 versus the Larry years.
This is only part one.
Because this is only part one. Let us know that on Twitter at AWM Podcast. And join our group, and hey, why don't you leave us a review? But Quinn, as they say, next week will be something completely different.
That's what they say.
That's what they say. Until that time, thank you guys so much for being with us here. We really do appreciate you, and this is Joe Morata and Michael Quinn saying so long. We'll see you next week for more As Wash Memories.
See ya.
Like what you heard? Be sure to leave a review and subscribe on your favorite podcast app. We will see you next week.